Good evening, welcome to the November 4th, 2015 Town Council meeting with the last meeting of the seated council. I'll call this meeting to order, so item number two, would you please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And item number three is roll call.
Counselor Bayby?
Present.
Counselor Donovan?
Here.
Counselor Caterina?
Here.
Counselor Blaze?
Here.
Counselor Hayes?
Here.
And Counselor Chair Holbrook.
And I am here and as promised in camo, so hats off to my kids, I did do it. So item number four is general public comments. If you would please rise and head to the podium, you can state your name, address, and you have 3 minutes. They are for non-agenda items.
Mike Turek, 11 Bayberry Lane. I want to thank both the departing counselors for their service years. I imagine that sitting where you do, knowing that you have 20,000 critics out there in the general public, is sometimes not an easy task. It is my opinion you've done a good job, and I want to thank you for your service.
Thank you, Mike.
Will Rowan, Bonnie Grove Drive. I would like to express my sincerest gratitude to the voters of Scarborough for the overwhelming support that I received in my bid for town council. As I prepare to transition into my new position, I remain fully cognizant that 3,600 votes were cast for candidates that did not win. I would like to thank Jim Benedict, Liam Summers, and Mike Turek for running exemplary issue-based campaigns. All three men are tremendous assets to our community, and I look forward to continuing to work with them and their supporters. I would also like to thank Councilors Blaze and Holbrook for their dedicated service. I'm just beginning to appreciate the challenges of a public life, and I will always remain grateful for any words of wisdom that they went to impact in moving forward. The hard work for me starts today. I look forward to working with the other councilors and the town manager on improving dialogue with all the residents of Scarborough, promoting smart business development, encouraging the creation of affordable housing options, and strengthening our service offerings and support for our senior community. I'm also looking forward to collaborating with the school board on getting a budget in place that will both satisfy voters and fulfill our obligation to the next generation. Scarborough will be immeasurably more pleasurable to live in when we stop talking past each other. There is no them, there is no us. We're one community who will succeed only when we move forward together. Thank you for entrusting me with this great privilege.
Thank you. Anybody else wish to speak? Oh, yes. We have Officer Moulton, Chief Moulton, sorry. I just downgraded you. Chief Moulton here to talk to us about Operation Rogue.
She doesn't have the authority to vote, so...
Thank you very much. I just wanted to take just a minute. I came before you back in mid-September to talk to you about the program that we wanted to roll out the 1st of October called Operation Hope, and I just wanted to give you a little update with that. We did open our doors on October 1st, and it has been what I would consider extremely successful. We've had a number of things happen. We've had 57 folks walk through the door looking for help with their addiction.
Wow.
It's really been an eye-opening experience for all of us, I think, to understand the magnitude of this problem and understand the struggles that that these folks are going through. And I've had the opportunity to sit with a number of them and listen to their stories and talk about where they're at and what has happened to them, their families, their careers, just their lives. And it's sad. This is a vicious disease. Of those 57 folks that have walked in, we've been able to place 36 of them to date. We have three pending right now. As of 4 o'clock this afternoon, there were three folks in getting screened and so forth. They have, we have tentative placements for them, and we expect they'll be back in the morning. They're in safe houses tonight. We expect them back in the morning and to make arrangements for transportation and so forth. We've of those folks that we have placed, we've had 9 that have had insurance. We've been fortunate that 27 of those folks that are uninsured have either gotten full scholarship beds, or families have come up with partial payments in order to get these folks into treatment. So it's we're certainly thankful for all of the treatment facilities that have stepped forward in Maine, New Hampshire, Connecticut, Pennsylvania, Florida, and California to take these people in and to get them treatment and try to put their lives back in order. So I'd be happy to answer any questions. We've also been fortunate enough that Project Grace has stepped up to be our fiduciary, and Steffi has worked with our folks to develop a website, which is now operational. It's www.operationhopemaine.org, Maine spelled all the way out. And that will have information on it. And as you probably are aware, we've been keeping people fairly up to date with our Facebook postings and so forth. So I just wanted to give you a quick update as to what it is. I thank you for your support. I think it's a desperate situation, and it's and this has done a number of things. Not only has it got people in treatment, but it has shined a light on the problem. And we are looking forward to November 19th. We're going to have a forum with elected officials. I believe you folks have already gotten your invitations, and the new councils, I believe, will have them, along with a bunch of folks from the Senate and House. And we're in hopes that we're also bringing some people in from Portland Recovery Center and some of the families of people that we've been dealing with, in hopes that people can get a better understanding of the magnitude of this problem and what's happening. We've also, as we've gone along, I think people have trusted us a bit more. In the very beginning, we had told people that you could bring in your drugs and paraphernalia and so forth, and you wouldn't be arrested. People came in through the door but didn't necessarily bring anything with them. And as we've progressed the last couple of weeks, we're seeing more and more folks bringing things in for disposal. So that's working as well. At least it's getting it off the street. Be happy to answer any questions you might have, but I just wanted to give you that brief update.
Chief, thank you so much. It's an amazing program that we're doing here at Scarborough, and I give you a lot of credit for that, as well as the officers who are helping with it and community members. A quick question: of these 57 people, are they from all over the state, or are they?
They
there?
Are. They are, yeah. You know, certainly some of them are Scarborough residents,
mm-hmm.
But we've had them for as far away as Bar Harbor. I think we had one from Caribou. We've had from as far south as Kittery. So, yeah, unfortunately, there's no other place, and particularly for those folks that don't have insurance, they have very, very little hope.
Would Medicaid expansion be helpful? I know I'm working on a political thing here, but, I mean, you guys are seeing the front end of whatever and why people are uninsured. Or
what makes it so much more difficult in Maine is that we don't have the Medicare expansion. In Massachusetts, they do, and they're able to bring folks in, and if they're not already on and they qualify, they're able to get them insured, and as soon as they get them insured, they're able to get them placed. Because these treatment facilities in other parts of the country have plenty of beds. It's just a matter of getting them there.
Sure.
And for those with insurance, it's pretty simple. But for those that aren't, it's
sure.
difficult. And we've been very fortunate to think that these treatment facilities have given us 27.
Oh, yeah, because treatment's expensive. Treatment
scholarship
expensive?
Beds, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Scholarships.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's going to run out.
It is. Unfortunately, that's what we're faced with. You know, this is a temporary solution. There certainly needs to be a comprehensive statewide strategy, because we're not going to be able to continue to do this. We've been fortunate enough that some folks have come forward and raised money for Operation Hope through Project Grace, and we have some money from grant money from PARI, the Police Assisted Addiction Recovery Initiative, and those folks are actually coming down tomorrow to meet with us. So we've been fortunate that we've been able to do that, but yeah, you're right. The bottom line is that you know, the goodwill is gonna run out, and it's gonna be unfortunate.
Chief, can you? I know you mentioned the 19th. I haven't had a chance to check all my emails, and I haven't seen the invitation yet for that forum. When and where?
I believe it's November 19th. It's actually going to be here.
Okay.
It's I believe it's 1 to 3:30, I believe.
Okay.
And I know why you haven't gotten it now that I think about it, because John had told me that he was waiting until the election.
Oh, okay.
So
right.
the
awesome.
New council members and so forth. But I've asked him to invite those that are going off the council as well.
Did you invite Senator King's office also, someone from there, since they're here in town?
I believe we have.
Okay.
And we've also reached out to somebody from the governor's office.
Awesome.
And and a variety of committees, and we have talked with different folks to see who the influential committee folks might be that would be able to come in and meet with us. So.
Thank you.
Sean.
This is one of the reasons why I love living in Scarborough. Just want to say thank you for everything that you and your officers do. And this is truly a outside-of-the-box process. As part of that outside-of-the-box process is, at what time do you think it will be appropriate for us, whether it's the council to help you or whether it's your own staff, to think about what's next? You know, what is our next step so that we stay ahead of it? Because, you know, we're one of the first communities to do it, and I hope that we remain the leader within that fight. So, you know, I hope that you come to us and whatever resources that you need that are appropriate and reasonable, that we're able to help with that. And, you know, I'll trust you. I mean, you've been around for a long time. But, you know, through Tom and everyone else, whatever we can do is just, it's extremely meaningful. Whether they are from Scarborough or whether they are from Mar Harbor, I think that what we're providing is absolutely the best thing that Scarborough can do as a community. It speaks volumes to the community as a whole. So I just want to say thank you and hope that you start thinking about what's next.
Well, thank you very much. We are thinking about what's next, and we're hoping that after the forum we'll have some better understanding of where we're going. And I do appreciate your support. I have to give the credit to John Gill and Jamie Higgins, who are the folks that put this together and brought it forward. Done a tremendous amount of work. I do want to point out, just for the record, that we're not spending any taxpayer money.
Right.
This is any money that has been spent is grant money or money that's been raised for Operation Hope. And the other thing, I think your comment about, you know, wherever these people come from, and I've had the question posed to me, why would we assist people from other communities and so forth? But the fact of the matter is that we're affected here in Scarborough by folks all over Maine that are in this situation. The people that come to a neighborhood here in Scarborough and rifle through cars looking for change and electronics and so forth are not always folks from Scarborough.
That's right.
Sometimes they are, but they're not always. The people that come to Walmart and other big box stores and shoplift to get money enough to go out and buy heroin are not Scarborough people all the time. So even though, yes, some of these people are not from right here, I think we're still all affected by what happens with these folks statewide.
Yeah.
Amen.
Thank you for clarifying that, because, you know, my point in asking it was that there is nothing else. We're at it, you know?
Yeah.
So, okay. Thanks.
It's true. And the other thing is that I would tell you that some of the people that we talked to, even people that have had insurance, have come in and told us that they have tried and tried and tried to get into treatment, and the insurance companies have blocked them. And until we get in contact with these treatment centers that know the system and understand what these insurance companies are required to do and hold their feet to the fire, that's when we've been able to get them help.
Yeah.
Sad statement.
It is a sad statement.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, yeah.
Okay, thank you, Chief Milton. And as always, you are an outstanding chief that Scarborough can be immensely proud of.
Yep.
So with that, we can move on to our next item, which is item number 5, minutes from the September 16th, 2015 regular meeting and the October 7th, 2015 regular meeting.
Move.
Is there a motion?
Move approval.
Second.
And any discussion, errors, omissions, and seeing none, all those in favor? And that is unanimous. Yeah, just a little thing.
Were you able to see them beyond the flowers?
Item number 6 is adjustments to the agenda. There are none at this
Madam
time.
Chair.
Oh, there's
I'd like to adjust the agenda, please.
So moved. What?
Do I have a second?
Second.
Second. And,
yeah. You want to stand up?
Oh, me?
Yeah.
Talk about being awkward.
On behalf of the citizens of Scarborough, I'd like to present you with this little gavel. I don't think it comes off, but she can whack her husband over the head.
Oh, my God.
Not her, you kids. But anyway, it says, presented to Jessica L. Holbrook in recognition and appreciation for your outstanding and dedicated service to the town of Scarborough, town councilor from 2009 to 2015, council chair 2015. I know, speaking for myself, I'm going to miss you tremendously. You've been a great mentor to me as a new counselor, and you've done such an awesome job with representing those of us who live on the other side of the turnpike. And
thank you very much. Standing up too. Uh-oh.
I would like to be able to present to Ed Blades this plaque from the citizens of the town of Scarborough in recognition and appreciation for your outstanding and dedicated service to the town of Scarborough as counselor from 2012 to 2015. I must say, Ed has really served us with honor and integrity. He has values that are good old-fashioned Maine values of thrift, and he's been true to those values as a councilman. And under his watch as a member of the Finance Committee, we have come in with budgets of 2.2 and 2.5% the last 2 years.
Right.
And it was a huge part of making that accomplishment. So congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
I got my tissues. Thank you. Well, thank you very much, and I'll save those comments for later. But so we're on to item number 7, items to be signed, casual warrants. I will sign those a little later in the meeting. And we're on to our next item, which is order number 15-077, is a 7 p.m. public hearing and second reading on the proposed amendments to Chapter 313A, the Town of Scarborough Property Tax Assistance Ordinance. And is there any member of the public that wishes to speak on this item? Again, it is the public hearing. So please rise and come to the podium and state your name and address for the records while our town clerk will draw it down, and you have 3 minutes.
Hi, I'm Joan Jagalinzer, and I live at 12 Cedarbrook East in Scarborough. And the folks that have worked on this ordinance have done a great job setting it up. I just have one request and consideration of the council, that you add to the the adjusted gross income to be considered, that you add the Social Security that's not included in the adjusted gross income. So you're making a level playing field for all of the residents of Scarborough who are otherwise qualified for this. And I can give you, I know I have to be over here. That's a quick analysis of when it would make a difference and when it wouldn't. And particularly if you look at the last one where it says couple, and then ignore right now for the one where it says singles, but for a couple, if you look at the column down there, you'll see the difference that it would make if we did not include the Social Security And so my request is to just change it so that there be a level playing field. And I, on the bottom, I've included a suggested change, and it's a relatively short change to make a level playing field for all the residents of Scarborough. Any questions? Thank you.
Thank you. Does anybody else wish to speak on this item? All right. And seeing none, I will close the public hearing. And I don't know if Tom or if Bill would be a little better suited to introduce
yeah.
this to us, but
I think I'll defer to Councilor Donovan.
Sure.
Sure.
I have had the opportunity to explain the program to everyone in the past, so I'll be relatively brief. It's really intended to provide a benefit for low-income seniors who've been in Scarborough a long time, 10 years or more, 62 years of age or older. We felt it necessary to develop this new Chapter 313A because the old program was, we were finding that the benefits were being reduced to appropriate and eligible seniors. And that was a consequence of having the program's eligibility tied to state eligibility, where state eligibility was changing from year to year in a rather dramatic fashion as a result of budget issues that the state was being impacted by. So we felt it was appropriate to have stability in this program, and so we set about working, Craig Friedrich and I, over months to try and come up with one that would be suitable for the town of Scarborough, given its socioeconomic and geographic setting. So that's what we have before us. There's several issues that I think I will say that we have erred on the side of simplicity so that the town's staff can apply this program without any undue expenditure of time or additional staff. That was important. There are several issues that we expect will be evaluated over the course of the first year so that we can get the bugs out. And we think that there are several areas that we can potentially make improvements, but we will not know until we've spent about a year studying how the program works. We're not certain that $500 is an appropriate limit. We have people who qualify, who do not qualify for the state program, but do qualify for our program. And when you compare that to other people who would qualify for our program and qualify for the state program, there's an inequity there. And we may have to address that, but we want to be able to see that. There's the possibility that there are property-rich individuals who really aren't intended to be the beneficiaries of this program, and we're going to be monitoring the program's applicants for that condition. The lady who spoke, thank you, who spoke a few moments ago, we worked back and forth over the issue of whether to try to make an amendment on Social Security, but it's a much bigger issue than that. There are other incomes that are not taken into account by federal AGI. Federal AGI was picked as the benchmark number from which to do the calculation of eligibility because almost everybody files a 1040. Therefore, everybody has a federal adjusted gross income. Is it perfect? No. Can we do better? Well, we may in the future make the program more complex to try and level the playing field, make it more equal for every applicant. But at the moment, the way we've structured the calculation, even people who
have pensions that are taxable compared to applicants who have Social Security, which is only gradually ebbed into the federal AGI number. It still allows those people who have taxable pensions to get the benefit of the program because of how much tax we as taxpayers have to pay. There is simply very few homes in Scarborough that pay less than $2,500 or $3,000. And so your eligibility is not being impacted by the fact that your income is included in the $50,000 limit, whereas somebody else's isn't. And it's a tough problem to deal with. I was glad that we had the opportunity to discuss this today, back and forth by emails, and I've offered the opportunity for our citizen to join Craig and I in the analysis that we'll do of this spring and next spring and next summer. There was one thing that I did since our last meeting on the first reading, and that was I wanted to get a sense of the scope of the problem of low-income people, seniors in town. So I asked, I got that help from Jim DeMesis, who had access to data from the Census Bureau, and I wanted everyone to see, and this is just a little chart that from the Census Bureau that Jim DeMesis put together that shows the number of, and this data was available for people over 65. The program operates for people over from 62 and up. But the number of people over the age of 60 or 65 and older who have household incomes below $50,000. And there are 1,200 households in Scarborough that have income less than $50,000. In fact, there are 500 households with income less than $20,000. So when you get down to $20,000, you're starting to get down to a very low amount of money on which to live in Scarborough, which is obviously a relatively expensive community, as many of the communities in southern coastal Maine are. So I wanted this information to be available to all of you because it really brought home to me the magnitude of the problem. It may well, many of these people may not be eligible under the other criteria, but besides the income criteria, but this may be a bigger problem than the 200 to 300 applicants that we've had in the past. And as we publicize this program, we may find it has a certain popularity. So we'll be monitoring that. So appreciate everyone's support for this. We do fully expect to take up the Social Security and other related taxes that are not included under federal AGI, municipal bonds, tax-exempt bonds, and other adjustments that occur to federal AGI. But for the moment, we think that this is a good place to start, given the limitations we have on staffing. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill, for introducing that to us. So at this point, we will need a motion.
So moved.
So we have a first and a second, and discussion. Sean.
Great work. I know many years ago, several of us at that time, which included Councilor Ahlquist, Richard Sullivan, myself, and several people, started at least discussing it and initially drafted what was the old program, and of course that changed over time. So I'm glad to see that it became more relevant after going through really a declining participation process. So I really appreciate it, Bill, on what you did and the leadership that you took with this. as well as to Mr. Fredericks. I attended a function, I guess, if that's what you want to call it, with Jean Marie Caterina up at, in Augusta, and one of the topics that was discussed was about, and I forget the and Jean Marie, you can remind me, it was really about the number of students that each of our districts are faced with that are undernourished, that are...
Oh, yes.
I can't remember the exact terminology. And it's hard to believe that 20% of our school children, which is about 600, are undernourished and qualify for a low-to-income reimbursement or food services. And this really, this data that you provided is just a tipping point of that, because this isn't just about one particular demographic. It's about a demographic that needs more services throughout the community as a whole. So I'm glad to see that we're facing this group of 65 and older, but there's more services that we need to provide long-term for other people that range from prenatal care to 100 years old, whatever it might be. And I hope that, if anything, this is the precept for us as a council, along with the new members, to take on what is now being termed as the aging in place dilemma, and how do we service this demographic, and how we service the transition of these people in our community over the lifetime. So I really appreciate the work that you've done on this, and I'm really excited about it, and I can't imagine anybody saying anything negative about the work and not supporting this.
Jean Marie?
I also thoroughly appreciate all of the work that's gone into it, Councilor Donovan and Mr. Friedrich. I've watched, I know when I campaigned a couple of years ago for this position that I'm in now, I talked to several elderly people, because that was at the point where the state was really shifting this away from the circuit breaker, which worked really well, in my opinion, to some political hybrids that don't work very well or don't work at all for a lot of people. So thank you for these statistics. This is eye-opening for me. As far as the number of households in a town like Scarborough. I know I see a lot of them. I know I made that comment to Jessica about representing our side of Scarborough. If you want to come over to my side of Scarborough, North Scarborough, West Scarborough, just drive around in some of the neighborhoods, you will see some real pockets of poverty and impoverishment. And older people who've lived in these houses for years, and I mean years and years and years, they were friends of my grandmother-in-law's, I should say, and they're in their 90s, some of them, barely hanging on, don't like to ask for anything, but could definitely, you know, use this program. So I'm thrilled to see it, and along with, you know, we were talking under our goals about what can we also be doing for senior programming as a goal, or as Sean was talking about, the aging in place initiatives that are I'd like to see happen. But anyway, I would fully support this, and again, I'd be really surprised. I'll be shocked if there's anyone in the community who does not support this. I'll be really shocked, but I've been shocked before.
Ed?
I'd just like to thank Bill and Craig for the outstanding job that they did on this. I think every senior in town, whether they qualify or not, respects what they've done. And they put a lot of work into this. I'm sure it's going to be very successful, and I'm sure they're going to stay right up on top of it and make changes as changes should be made. Certainly supported 100%.
Bill, just a point of clarity, that the information, what do we think the price tag of this is on an annual basis? When I thought we were talking, how many households do you think will qualify for the maximum?
We've had a recent history, I think, of 270, 280,
okay.
And then it dropped down to about 200. From close to 300, from around 300. So as the program got changed at the state level, we dropped from about 300
households that were benefiting from this program to about 200 households.
So of the 1,200 that you have here, because that's what I was thinking. I was thinking the number was in that 200 to 300 range.
And we...
How do so many drop off of the eligibility of those?
I was told by the Maine Municipal Association lobbyist many very, very low-income people, and I'm glad you mentioned that because there was an interesting fact in this data that I neglected to mention, do not file tax returns because they're not obligated to file tax returns. And the complexity of the state process to become eligible, and our eligibility was dependent upon state eligibility, so was so onerous that they chose simply not to do it. And the first line of the data sheet says that there are 194 households in Scarborough with income of less than $10,000. Data that I have, but I didn't pass it out because I didn't want to just overwhelm people, breaks that out by male and female. The 194 broke out 194 females and zero males.
Yeah.
194 females with who are the head of the household making less than $10,000 household income. Shocking statistic.
Thank you, Bill. Any other questions, discussions? All right. I'll chime in just last minute. I do applaud Bill and of course Greg Frederick for taking this on. Certainly it's been an issue that our program was coupled with the state's program, so thank you. And there may be, you know, a few kinks to kind of figure out and things to you know, fix and you know, along the way. But certainly it's one of those scenarios that I think the work and the intent is too important to just say, well, let's wait until it's perfect, because you might wait forever to make it perfect and to find out that you need to change it again anyway. Certainly I think, you know, I have faith that Bill will continue to work on this as it shapes and comes forward, and I'm really happy to see this come forward. The one thing I would just say, and I mentioned in my comments the last time during our first reading, was that I do hope after a year's worth of experience with the program as it's new and finding out how much participation there is, that the council could perhaps review the dollar figure associated with that.
Mm-hmm.
In the inception of this program, the cap was 500. That was several years ago at this point, and you know, perhaps that number should be adjusted up some to kind of reflect the burden and load of the people we're looking to help.
Mm-hmm.
With that,
and I must say, on an evening that is Ed Blaze's last evening, he proposed and saw through the adoption of a provision that if we had any money left over from this budget line item,
right,
it went into a reserve account and was available for future use. And I think that's going to help us in the funding of what might be a greater demand, since the if we run out of money, it becomes a pro rata sharing by people. But hopefully we'll have enough as a result of Ed's wisdom years ago.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Any other discussion? All right, seeing none, all those in favor, and that is unanimous. All right, on to our next item. Order number 15-082 is a 7 p.m. public hearing and second reading on the proposed amendments to Chapter 601, the Town of Scarborough Traffic Ordinance, Section 25, Parking Restrictions, Section A, Parking Restrictions, Subsection 2, Higgins Beach regarding metered parking. Again, this is a public hearing. If anybody wishes to speak on this item, please rise and head to the podium and state your name and address, and you have 3 minutes. And anybody wish to speak for the public hearing?
Hello there, Melissa Gates with the Surf Rider Foundation. I'll be brief. I've already commented about the meters in the past. Really, this is a non-solution to the root issues that have been brought before the council, which are behavioral issues. So drilling down to tackle violations of one-hour parking by installing meters at a huge cost to your community really isn't going to do much to help us get to the root issues here. And we're all going to be right back here in a matter of a year, maybe 2 years, fighting the same fight. And I just want to encourage you guys to please reconsider and dig a little bit deeper to really try to come around to a community-minded solution that considers the surfers, the homeowners, everyone in Scarborough. We had over 400 people who are residents of your town who signed on to our petition asking you not to do anything here. That's a lot of people that we're not listening to. So I just hope that meters aren't the be-all and end-all solution. Hanging on to that free beach-adjacent parking is really a special thing. And what you're trying to solve here are behavioral issues that the meters aren't going to even get to a little bit. So I hope that we can dig deeper and come back around to discussion rather than moving this forward. Thanks.
Thank you. Does anybody else wish to speak on this item?
Hi, Terry Kane. I live at Gunstock Road. My family, extended family, has a place at Ocean Avenue on Higgins Beach. I want to say thank you first to everyone here that has tolerated this going on for the last how many ever weeks it's gone on. I've gotten a great education about it, and I appreciate the times you've put up with the old gravelly voice here and with all the other folks who have spoken on both sides. I just wanted to say I've changed my thoughts on this a couple of times, maybe three times during the whole process, including the last meeting. It seems last time everybody was focused on enforcement as the only solution. Nobody wanted to listen to some of the locals who said they had difficulties with this or that. It was just, let's enforce what's already there. Surf Riders insisted it was the only acceptable solution, and I've come to agree with that enforcement is the right solution. I disagree with the idea that a camera stationed on one end of the street is going to help enforce anything. What do you do, dispatch when the camera catches somebody in the act of the bad behavior? Who monitors that? All of that costs a lot of money and is ineffective. It's of zero use for the overtime parking, which I think is a significant issue because it drives a lot of the other issues. If we have people follow the rules that they are, then I think we can tolerate leaving the rules as they are. Eliminating the spaces, which I've heard some people that in my Higgins Beach community have advocated, to steal somebody else's phrase, that might be too far too fast. If we can't ever solve anything else, maybe that's on the table, but I don't think it is. I've come to support the meters. I never thought I would do that, but they are unobtrusive. There's one small station. There's no blight on the community. They're simple. It's scheduled enforcement. It can't be fudged. If you are doing the technology right, then we'll know when people have been there more than an hour. The certainty of being fined if you're there for more than an hour is what will make the behavior change. The second thing is the cost. I think that's definitely an issue. If we talk about doubling the fines, there's other ways to make sure we cover the costs. I think the meters should be darn near free, maybe a quarter or free. But here's my last thought on it. If we don't quite cover it, if we miss it by a couple of thousand dollars, somebody said I think the total cost was $17,000, I'm not sure. What if we consider it, let's invest in a compromise. The 7 a.m. start remains after some discussion either way. There's no half hour, which kind of defeated itself after we explored it, and I kind of favored that for a while. Enforce the hour so that more people can enjoy it. No one will be there for 2 or 3 hours because we can't enforce it chalking the tires. Now you can enforce it, so we'll reach the goal of the compromise of having more people enjoy it. It'll encourage the few offenders to go use the facilities, and it's somewhat better for the residents who've had their issues. So even if we don't quite break even, let's invest in compromise. It's a pretty good solution for all parties, I believe, and I think we ought to try it. There's been a ton of discussion recently in this town about divisiveness. Here's a place where we could take a decision, which I think you guys have explored, and you're probably leaning in favor of it, that would show a little bit in the other direction. It's compromise. It's something we probably need to finish this off with, and I think this is the best one available to us. And again, thank you for all your tolerance.
Thank you. Next speaker. By all means, too, feel free to line up at the podium if you'd wish to speak.
Joan Laurie, East Grand Avenue in Scarborough. I've spoken before. You know my concerns. I've written to all of you, but I'm still mystified over how we can possibly consider for 11 parking spaces spending up to $17,000. It's absurd. Scarborough has so many more needs. You were talking about, you know, funding for senior citizens that are living at $10,000 a year to support themselves or maybe a family. I mean, it's really, if it were $2,000, maybe I could understand it. But I don't see how there will ever be a break even. And I mean, the whole thing started with people being concerned about unruly behavior. This does not address that. But my primary concern as a taxpayer is up to 17. It's just, I don't know where the rest of the Scarborough residents are that pay into those taxes to not be here lined up behind me complaining about that. But thank you all for your service. Those that are leaving, thank you as well. And it's difficult. People have asked me, you know, are you interested in being on the council? And there is no way that I could do what you do. So thank you. It's a hard job, but you do it well. Thank you.
Hi, Elaine Richard, Fibrief Lane, 28 East Grand. I'm also going to talk about the $17,000. Last year, we had an issue in Pine Point where we needed to have the beach cleaned more than once a week. And we looked to the beach administration budget, and there was no money. No money to clean an entire beach. And it was going to cost $25,000, and there's no money. Now, from the same budget, there was no money last year, you're going to take $17,000 and you're going to put in 11 meters. Now, if you put the 11 meters in, we may not get our beach cleaned at Pine Point, but if you compare 11 meters and a whole beach cleaning, I mean, do we have the money? I mean, if we've got the money for both, I think that's just great. If we don't, this is crazy. I'm sorry. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker.
I'm Maureen Sear. I live at Higgins Beach, and I'm not affected by the meters because I'm down at the spit. And I didn't plan to speak on this. I'm not here for that reason. But I saw it in the newspaper, I rolled my eyes, and I said, when are they ever going to stop hounding Higgins Beach? I'm so tired of reading in the paper how bad Higgins Beach is and all the rich people coming in from away and people doing this. I don't see the people changing their clothes every so often. I see someone wrapped in a towel. But I think there's so much micromanagement. I think finally the dog issue has been addressed. It seemed to work well last year. We had some plovers. And now it's like the micromanagement piece. I remember my mom used to drive out to the beach and park there just to look at the waves. So what if we get seniors coming and they're not that healthy, they can't walk that well, and they've got to walk down the end to get their ticket, stick it in there just to sit and look at the waves? I don't know. I think the 11 spaces, I think there's just too much of an issue being made of it. It's like fighting over such a minor thing when the town should really move on to other issues. There will always be people that will take advantage of it. There are people that will not pay the fine even though they're fined. and other people that will respect the current rules. So I don't know. I got kind of frustrated when I saw that in the paper, and I guess I'm venting. But that's it. I think we should kind of just leave it as it is. Let those who are not obeying the rules suffer as much as they can, or they can run away and you never see them again. But anyway, that's my opinion. I think sometimes we can't take care of everything. We can't tell the ants how to build their hills or something like that.
Thank you. Anybody else for the public hearing? All right. And seeing none, I will close the public hearing. And before I take a motion, Tom, would you mind introducing this particular section of the that we're working on, which is the order?
Yes, this order is a very simple amendment of the traffic ordinance, which is a large document. The traffic ordinance is broken up, and in this chapter deals with all the parking regulations townwide. And so this simply adds the word metered. Some have suggested that's not even required, but I think staff would like that just to make sure that there's no question that meters are to be placed there. The administration and the details of that are certainly something that myself and the police department can work through. But this simply adds the word metered, which gives us the authority and the directive to make that happen.
And so just to reiterate, the item in front of us, the days, the hours, the times, and all those good things do not change. It is simply adding the word metered to the section of parking on Bayview. So with that, is there a motion?
So moved.
Second. We have a first and a second. Discussion. Councilor Raveline.
So I have to ask a question. What is the spit? She said she lived down at the spit. I learn something new every time. What part of... Can you come up to here? So, because people are listening as well. So
they want to know too.
They want to know too. I mean, it's just like I learned what Jones Creek is.
I don't think this is the real technical thing, but I bought my home from a realtor that was not the one who made a comment, and I bought my house and I live around there for 12 years. And so he said, oh, you bought your house on the spit of Higgins Beach. And I thought, well, that's kind of mean-spirited just because I didn't buy from him. And then I found out the spit is a little piece of land that kind of juts out into the water. I guess it's like spit, you know?
Yep.
And anyway, that's it.
I appreciate
that. So I live down there near the river, near the ocean.
I appreciate that very, very much. It gives me perspective, so thank you.
That
was our fault of learning. Absolutely. I just needed that clarification, and I have comments later, but I had to think about that first.
curious George Babine.
Yep.
Anybody else? Ed Blaise.
I'm going to support this. I don't really think that this is the solution to the behavior problem, but it's about the only thing that we we can get through the council, I believe. The council passed 4 years ago allowing parking down there. And I believe, had they known then what the behavior issues are today, they never would have passed it. Mm. There still would be no parking down there. But with that in mind, I think we've got to do something. I think this is a good start. We can try it, and because it's a special meter, it's the credit card meter, 1 meter for all the spots. It's not going to be a whole bunch of little poles sticking up along the street like everybody thinks. It'll be one station. It hasn't been determined yet whether we're going to charge, but if we do charge, I mean, we could make this pay for itself. The $17,000, it could pay for itself. So I'm in favor of it.
Thank you, Councilor Blaise. Councilor Hayes.
I guess where I weigh in is I won't support this because I really feel the meter is really, as we've heard tonight, really don't address the original problem. What was presented was there was an excessive noise problem. There was a public nudity problem. I really feel this doesn't solve any of those things. Secondly, not only is it the $18,000 this year to install it, but it's an additional $18,000 every year just to do the enforcement. And I'm concerned because as we look around, I remind everybody that last year we canceled seventh grade sports for less than that amount of money. Two, this year we've had pleas from the public safety areas, both the fire department and police department, about public safety issues. They're needing more resources to do some things. And I take my son to school every morning, and I go through this intersection up here at Oak Hill. I have seen almost every day people running red lights there. There's going to be a fatality at some point in time. So I just think as a community, as tight as resources are, is this the highest and best use of our resources to spend another $18,000 a year enforcing parking for 11 spots? So based on that, I don't think this is a solution. This feels like it's a solution looking for a problem. I'd rather take the time and do it right and really try to figure out what's going to work down there. So I'm not going to support it.
Councilor Tarvino.
I am supporting this change to the traffic ordinance of adding metering. I have given a lot of thought to this, and actually I have a question for either our finance chair or the town manager regarding, it's my understanding that the money for this is coming out of a dedicated fund, which can't be used for anything other than improvements to beaches. Is that correct? And if so, how much money is usually in that account, and what's the source of those money?
My recommendation would be to use beach revenues. I think dedicated is too strong a word.
Okay.
It is, these funds are segregated.
Okay.
Can
you explain so the public will understand?
Well, these are revenues derived by through all sorts of beach activities we have, predominantly parking. We have a fund that segregates those funds separately from tax dollars, and to date, we've been able to offset all operational costs related to beach activities,
mm-hmm.
parking attendance, and even capital improvements. In fact, we built the bathhouse at Higgins Beach using these funds, non-tax dollars. There may come a point where our operational costs exceed
mm-hmm.
Those revenues, but we're not there yet. In fact, the Finance Committee members will recall one of the late changes in the budget was to increase the amount of beach revenues coming into the budget this year because the fund
mm-hmm.
could tolerate it. So the programmed or the suggested $18,000 in enforcement cost can be covered currently and for the foreseeable future with those non-property tax revenues.
Okay. Thank you for the answer to that. I personally would like to see, and I can see at some point, that during the busiest times of the summer that we would charge for the parking down there. Minimal amount, but we would do some charging of that. But again, that's not on the table tonight. But it would certainly be, you know, open. The other thing I'm looking at with doing this metering is I would like to see us do metering in the parking lots at some point so you don't have the human resource tied up and sitting there in a beach chair waiting for cars to come and go to take money. But you have a metering at the beach, and when I say beaches, I'm also talking about Pine Point. And, you know, possibly using meters elsewhere in town as necessary. So, again, I'm going to support this for a number of different reasons, not the least of which is this has been vetted, talked about, looked at, listened to, gotten emails and whatever on both sides, and to me this is the way to go at this point. So it does have my vote. Thank you.
Councilor Bedlam.
Thank you. So I want to clarify some of the numbers, if I can, through the chair, maybe to the manager.
Mm-hmm.
So the original memo from the manager said that it was, and I'm going to round, about $17,500 is what is needed to implement the meter process. My understanding is that there aren't 11 meters. There's not 13 meters. There's one meter for all of them. Is that correct?
Yes, my proposal.
Okay.
Yes.
Second is that as part of that $17,500, $8,500 of that is related to staffing costs and implementing this early out of budget cycle,
mm-hmm.
which requires you as our town manager, in order to implement anything, must have a budget allocation, and if not in a budget cycle, It has to be adjusted as part of that. So that's why the 8.5 is there. The reason is that that 8.5 will be part of the normal budget going forward. It's not an addition. It's already included because of the alignment and potential realignment of resources that are that will support this program. Is that correct?
I beg your pardon. I'm not sure if I understand the final part of your question. The $8,500 asked for in the resolution that we'll take up shortly gets us funding that's not currently in the budget to ensure that we can make this work this spring.
Right.
On a going forward basis, I would anticipate, should you wish to continue this path, we would include it in the budget request and it would be incorporated as part of the budget. So there is an annualized cost, as Councillor Hayes said, of about $18,000,
right,
on a going forward basis for enforcement.
However, because we haven't had that conversation, that could be funded by a realignment of other resources from departments to be able to support that, isn't that
correct? Yeah.
So it's not, we do not know whether or not there is truly an additional adjustment as a result of that, because the Finance Committee has not discussed how to fund that going forward, because
right,
it could be absorbed by existing processes. So my point in emphasizing these is that we're overstating what the financial impact is. I mean, and let's keep in perspective, we have as a community a $73 million budget with a $28 million community budget, a municipal budget, in which we're talking about $17,000. I don't find that as astronomical. I don't find that as harming in any stretch of the imagination to the overall impact of our community, especially when that is coming from dedicated reserves that have already been saved as a result of other efficiencies. The other thing to keep in mind, if I remember correctly, the statistics that were provided to us, I believe that the police department issued 250 tickets approximately down at Higgins Beach as a result of violations. That alone, at the maximum, if the charge is the maximum of $80, pays for the installation, even if you wanted to argue that we didn't have the money, because that's $20,000. So while my goal isn't necessarily to increase the number of tickets that we receive, at least the current behavior is supporting the change that we're asking for that will hopefully impact future behavior. I agree with everyone who says that this does not change the attitude or the behavior of the people that are visiting Higgins Beach. There isn't one thing that we can do as a town council that will change that, unless we go back to every single person's parents and slap them and say, you didn't bring up your child properly and you respect other people, because that is exactly what we're dealing with. People aren't respecting other people. Point blank. That is plain and simple. Whether it is bearing everything that you have, or whether it's the noise that you're projecting from your car, whatever it might be, and I'm not disagreeing that we all need to have greater tolerance in how we deal with other people. We live in a community and that happens. But there is a breaking point that I think that everyone has to sit there and say, enough is enough, and I think we have to be respectful for those who are unhappy about it. Just as much, we have to be respectful for those who say, this is really more than what it really needs to be. I respect both sides of that. I actually look at this solution not really as a solution to the noise, the undressing, even the parking issues. I actually look at this as a long-range solution to what I think is going to be the future of Scarborough, in which we can use new technology to optimize our services as part of all of our parking, whether it's Heard Park, whether it's, and this is just a small pilot program, including the parking lot that's across from the Higgins Beach Inn, that is that lot there, and becoming, basically an automized gate. And I think that the manager will manage this appropriately, will inform us how the activities are going and how it is going to be implemented and what the outcomes are. And I'm actually very excited about it, because the fact is that if we don't have technology to help us, then it's going to take human capital and people, and 9 times out of 10, that's more costly over the long run. And I think that this is just a logical step forward, and this is one of those solutions that kind of, I hope, makes everyone feel a little bit better about what we're dealing with. It's not going to be a cure-all by any stretch of the imagination, but I think that, Mr. Kane was spot on in his analysis. It's at least a step forward, and it's the right step forward that's not too drastic, in which we talk about getting rid of the actual parking spaces, because I don't think that's a solution either.
Okay, any other discussion? All right, time for me. For all the reasons stated previously by some of Ms. Counselor Bayline and Jean Marie and Ed, I will say that we are just talking about the actual ordinance change, which is metered. We are, just to recap, not talking about changing the hours or charging for the time or anything like that. We are just talking about the ordinance. So I'll kind of keep my comments around the ordinance itself. I think it is not a fix-all solution for everything, but I think it is probably about the only thing we could do to try to offer a little more enforcement and a little more control and to have a little more order down there. At the end of the day, it is a beach. A beach is a beach is a beach. It's never going to be orderly and perfect. It's not a Catholic school. And they're not all walking down in rows and hats and bows. So there is a certain level of noise and things and behaviors, but certainly it's probably one of the better steps we can take and probably the largest step we can take. So with that, I'll support it, and I have some comments for the money part after, when we get there for the resolution, which is in two more items away. So with that, all those in favor, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, and all those opposed is 1 for Councilor Hayes. On to the next item, which is order number 15-083, is a 7 p.m. public hearing and action on the new request for a massage therapist license from Marissa Heichel, working at Lucinda's Day Spa, located at 311 Beach Ridge Road. Is there anybody that wishes to speak on this item? All right, and seeing none, I will close the public hearing and pleasure of the council.
So moved.
Second.
And any discussion? All right. Seeing none, all those in favor of the license, and that is unanimous. Now we're on to our next one, which is the money. Resolution 15-006, asks to authorize the town manager to pursue meters and associated enforcement expenses for Higgins Beach from the beach revenue account, an amount not to exceed $17,000. And before we dive into comment, if you would, I realize we talked readily about this,
mm-hmm.
but if you would just recap for us, Tom.
Sure. I was tasked with exploring, researching, and providing a proposal to the council regarding a metered solution to address some of the concerns that have been raised to the council. I must admit I saw this as an opportunity perhaps to expand that and strongly considered in my proposal and my research to at least take on the Higgins Beach parking lot as part of this initiative as well. But very quickly we appreciated that there's a level of complication and cost. And I do note that we're mid-budget year, and I don't believe the council likes to, and nor do I like to ask for large sums of money out of budget cycle. And frankly, staff needs to do a little more work understanding the implications of managing a lot with this technology. I think it's imminent, but we just weren't ready to move forward. I also thought at the time that it would be most cost-effective to use civilian parking staff, and that may well be the case down the road. But after consultation with the chief and the director of community services, it became pretty clear that for us to make sure we can deliver enforcement, which is what I think is the heart of this proposal, we really need someone credible to be able to make that happen. And our reserve officers, we believe, have the requisite skills to be able to deliver those services. Of course, the meters alone do nothing for compliance, and you really need the appropriate level of staff support. So what's before you today would be intends to provide us resources to buy the materials to install one meter, so-called meter station, which certainly is capable of handling 11 spaces. It would be placed somewhere equidistant of all spaces, probably at the end of Ashton Street in that vicinity. And essentially, the patron would be required to go to the station, retrieve the ticket, which would have, I should mention also, they'd be prompted to include their license plate number, so there's something that ties the ticket to a vehicle. that ticket would need to be displayed, so it's easily viewed from outside the vehicle, typically on the dashboard, and then the person will be allowed to park. My proposal is for it to be free, but that's a discussion and a decision point for this council for another day, perhaps. The system certainly is smart enough not to issue another ticket to that license plate without some time passage to ensure that folks don't just simply shuffle one space ahead. I thought that was in trying to address what I believe was the concern. So the proposal has really two components. One is to purchase the meter. There are monthly costs associated to service that. There's some small installation expense, and then most importantly, there's a staff expense to really expand the reserve officer's hours. And they would essentially coincide with the allowable time frame for parking, actually an extra half hour on either side so the person can come and go and out of their shift. And that's certainly not a small expense. There's an annualized cost that we could expect on a going forward basis of about $18,500 in additional staff costs. That's not to say those monies couldn't be, it would be discussed in the mix of all the other priorities before the council as part of the overall budget request. So that's what's before you. This is certainly proven technology, something we can implement very easily and be up and running well in time for the summer, spring season 2016.
Thank you, Tom, for introducing the resolution. Is there anybody that wishes to speak on this item? And seeing none, I will close comments. And pleasure of the council.
Move approval.
Second.
In discussion.
I really just overall, as far as the analysis that the manager provided and the details regarding the vendor and the type of machine, that is really, I think, eco-friendly and can work very well down in that particular area. The fact that it is wireless, solar, and can be removed during the winter months, I think is added benefit to that. I look forward to the further recommendations. I do hope there's one consideration, and that is that the fines that are levied or eligible by the other policy or the other ordinances that come right before the previous ordinance that we just talked about, I think it was 22, 23, and 24, that we maximize the potential impact to discourage the behavior. Because I think that the current language says that the maximum fine is $80. However, if paid within 30 days, it's
right.
40. I would hope that, for lack of a better term, I hope that they have to pay the full $80.
Anybody else? Mr. Hayes?
Yeah, I guess I'll cycle back to, again, have us to really think about, is this the highest and best use of resources in our town? And some of the conversation around somehow this is free money or found money, but it's not. It's still an expenditure that we're taking on that we're currently not doing. And those beach funds, those monies, you put them in a reserve. They can be used to relieve the burden of taxpayers if we so want it. But I think there's a bigger issue, and we certainly had a member at Pine Point, a resident of Pine Point, come up and said if there wasn't money to clean the red tide off the beach, if there wasn't enough money in the reserves, why are we allocating money for this rather than that? And I will say that I've talked to a bunch of property owners down there. The red tide on that beach has a huge economic impact for all the residents down there that are trying to rent their homes and other things, and it's keeping tourists off the beach. So I just think, is this an annual expenditure of $18,000 to monitor 11 parking spaces the best use of the town resources? Is that the best place to put our monies to work? And if we're not going to change behaviors, as I've already conceded, I just make an appeal saying we're facing challenging budget times. Is that money better used directed someplace else? That I'll leave it at that.
I just have to offer a clarification to Ms. Richter and the point you just made. There certainly are adequate monies in the reserve account. The issue that we are confronted with is there aren't adequate monies in the current budget. So if the council wished to, by resolution, allocate additional money mid-budget year for cleaning
extra rigging.
Or beach, that's certainly possible. I just, it's, I just want to be clear what the difference is.
It's choice, yeah.
It's choices, right. But there certainly are adequate resources to provide additional service to Pine Point Beach,
mm-hmm.
if that's the desire.
Thank you, Tom. Dee Marie, we'll let her know.
Just through the chair, a quick clarification, Mr. Manager.
Mm-hmm.
The beach fund money, does that come from parking fees? I mean, where are we
predominantly, there are boat launch fees, there are other ones, but the predominant funding source is parking fees.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Bebe?
You know, I just want to reiterate, $8.2 thousand out of a $29 million budget is what's being allocated as out of the reserve fund for sunk costs, which is the cost of the meter. The remaining balance is really operating costs that would be considered as part of that budget, and I would hope that we fully take into consideration where optimization and efficiencies within the departments can absorb that so it doesn't become an additional burden. I do think that this is the highest and best use given the circumstances. And the fact is that you can make that arbitrary statement with every single expenditure that the town places. Is it the highest and best use that we purchase an additional fire truck? Is it the highest and best use that we purchase an additional school bus? It's based upon personal opinion and not based upon community sentiment, I think. And I'm not disrespecting that notion. I'm just suggesting is that we're all going to have different opinion about whether or not it's highest and best use. There is no absolute answer to that. And there won't be one even amongst the citizens if we ask them what their intention was. So I think this is. It's a good use of the beach revenue funds. It's supposed to be what it's used for.
Thank you, Councilor Brabine. Councilor Blaine.
Tom, I just have one question here about the first year, the cost to monitor is $8,500, and then each additional year it's $18,500. Why?
Well, one, we're mid-budget year, so this is just funding for the spring enforcement. That's really the difference in the cost.
That's all you ever do. You're only going to do it for 90 days, a year.
Well, our fiscal year ends June 30th, so this proposal in the resolution before you adds additional funding to the budget to get us through this fiscal year to the annualized cost of the expanded enforcement.
Oh, so the $8,500 is for the...
It's from...
April through June 30th, or whatever
May 1st or June 30th, basically.
Okay. Well, doesn't take into account the fact that you could charge money for these spots, which we should be doing.
No, it does not. This is simply the expenditure required to...
And if we charge a dollar for each spot for 90 days and only said, well, the spots are only going to be occupied 50% of the time, that's probably close to $8,000 right there. So I think this thing will pretty much pay for itself if we chose to pay for parking. Okay, that's all I wanted.
Thank you, Councilor Blaise. Does anybody else wish to speak? All right, so I will say a couple of thoughts. The first one was, unfortunately, as far as the I wrote red tide, that's not what I meant, I meant red seaweed. But as far as the seaweed, unfortunately, the first I had ever heard of it was earlier this fall.
Yeah.
I wasn't aware. I'm not a beach person, so I don't go down there other than, you know, look out over the water occasionally, but I don't frequent Pine Point Beach, so I didn't realize that was an issue. Certainly, you know, that's something that, as Tom mentioned, could be addressed later from the beach reserve account. Again, it's a reserve fund. That's what it's there for. You're a council. You can authorize those funds at any time. Well, as long as there's funds there. but certainly we could do that. And it is probably a worthwhile, you know, adventure. I think it would behoove us to wait
into next year to see if that's a similar occurrence or if that was a fluke one-year occurrence. But, but again, you know, if it's something that were to happen and it was happening frequently again next season, you as a council certainly have that right and opportunity to manage it accordingly. As for the initial expenditure, I talked about this in my comments the last time. As far as the order of $17,000, some of that is for the enforcement, some of that is for the purchase of the unit. And I still believe that this is an excellent opportunity to pilot this technology. I think there is, you know, no matter what direction the community goes, you know, after you get a season with and some experience with this, whether that's green light move forward, that the technology was successful, we'd like to put that in our other lots and in other areas. There would be an offsetting cost savings because you're no longer paying for the parking lot attendance. So it's quite possible, you know, these numbers balance out a lot further than what you're seeing this evening. So for me as a counselor, like I said, to be able to have the opportunity to pilot this for future savings is a great opportunity. Certainly there's not a ton of harm if it's unsuccessful for some reason and you decide not to continue with it or to expand it. You don't. So I think it's worth a try. I guess that's my point. So with that, any other discussion? Sorry for my sniffles.
No, all of a sudden.
Sorry to leave us. I am a member. All right, well, no other discussion. All those in favor, that is 1, 2, 3, 4. And all those opposed is 1 with Councillor Hayes being opposed. There is no old business at this time, so we'll go ahead and move into new business, which is order number 15-084, first reading and schedule a planning board public hearing on the proposed amendments to Chapter 405, the Town of Scarborough Zoning Ordinance, to establish a new section, Higgins Beach Character-Based Zoning Districts and Building Standards. And before we take any public comment on this, we'll go ahead and have, I think we had
Dan
to introduce this item to us.
In the interest of time, I might suggest that Dan speak to the next three orders.
Okay,
that's 84, 85, and 86.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. We'll continue the Higgins Beach theme this evening and turn to zoning. We conducted actually a workshop with the council back in early October, October 7th, on this matter. So I don't have a PowerPoint presentation for you this evening, given the territory we covered back at the workshop. But if the council would like, at your next meeting, should this move to public hearing, at the next consideration, there'll be two new councilors, and there'll be more opportunity for public comment. So that might be a good time where I'd provide more of a presentation to particularly those new council members. I think as this council is aware, we've been collectively working on this for the past 6 or 8 months, including intensive design charrette process in June at Higgins Beach, which got this project kicked off and got a lot of good neighborhood input. And we're excited to present to the council this evening for first reading the new zoning code that's proposed for Higgins Beach. And it's a zoning code that's unique for Scarborough and it's unique to Higgins Beach. It's really customized for the lot sizes, the historic, the development pattern of Higgins Beach, and the character of Higgins Beach. And it's really aimed at trying to free up property owners through zoning to have some ability to add on, to renovate, to build new at Higgins Beach. The current zoning doesn't allow that very well at all. In most cases, any additions, new construction, renovations of any consequence, either need to go to the Zoning Board of Appeals and ask for a variance, which isn't really a proper review process for something that's typical in a neighborhood, or results in sort of an awkward addition where they're allowed to do it given the very generous setbacks and other requirements based on the lot sizes at Higgins Beach. So with these kind of many months of getting input and thinking about Higgins Beach, we've really tried to come up with a balanced approach through this character code. There's folks at Higgins Beach that feel like recent development and changes have kind of eroded the character of Higgins Beach, the built environment of Higgins Beach. Kind of there's a feeling of some construction being overbuilt. And then there's also folks that really desire to see Higgins, properties at Higgins Beach be modernized, be four-season homes, have some expansion potential. So not to provide too much of an analogy to your earlier items, we're trying to come up with a balance here through zoning so that folks are allowed to expand, build new with more living space, more development footprint, but also within reason, considering the density and the constraints down there. So that's really the background as to why we're working on it and the grounding pieces of the proposal. And so in your first item, that's the proposed new zoning districts. The primary district is a new residential district that applies to the vast majority of the property at Higgins Beach. And then there's a very limited mixed-use district that allows residential and some light commercial uses, but that's identified only for the four existing non-residential or commercial properties at Higgins Beach. So there isn't a proposal to broaden the amount of commercial development that can occur at Higgins Beach, but rather recognize those commercial properties and allow them, like the residential properties, to become conforming and to do some things and to maintain their commercial establishments. So in the character code, as it's called, is a wide range of kind of specifics and standards that try to dictate new construction, kind of fit in with old in terms of where the buildings go, how they're added onto, how tall they are, you know, all the various kind of standards around that. And also to provide really a menu of how folks would go about renovations or additions. So the ordinance is rather long because there's a lot of different options that are provided and a lot of different standards that someone might use and another applicant may not need to use. Another component of the code is to try to acknowledge and recognize some of the environmental regulations that aren't zoning regulations. There's shoreland zoning dictated by the state. There's floodplain requirements given the location of many of the properties. There's sand dune regulations by DEP. So there's a variety of other regulations that we've included in the code just for reference and ease of use as folks are trying to navigate these kind of complex issues. So that's, in a nutshell, what's in the proposed zoning districts and so-called character code. And that's, you know, the first order that's before you. As Tom mentioned, there's two other orders. The second one is the actual zoning map amendment, which delineates where this new residential district will apply and where those four properties are that would are earmarked for the mixed-use limited zone. So that's the second order. And it includes really all of Higgins Beach out to Spurlink Road, including the Higgins Beach Market. That's the most sort of inland property, and we felt that given the importance of the market to the Higgins Beach community, it's appropriate to include that property, even though it's across the street from kind of the rest of Higgins Beach. And there are a few areas of Higgins Beach that aren't included that really don't have sort of the historical character or the same characteristics. Harmon's Island is not included. There's 6 to 8 properties out there that are essentially built out. There's it doesn't have a lot of the same kind of lot dimensions and details of the core of Higgins Beach. Kelly Lane isn't included. It's a newer street. The houses that are on Kelly Lane meet the current R4 requirements, so they've been developed under the current zoning that That was established long after Higgins Beach. And then the two different kind of condo developments as you come into Higgins Beach are sort of in the same boat as Kelly Lane. They're not of the same pattern and character of the rest of Higgins Beach. Other than that, the majority of the properties at Higgins Beach would fall into these districts. The third order that's before you is actually a shoreland zoning ordinance amendment, and that's proposed to be amended to try to align the zoning, the regular zoning at Higgins Beach, with the shoreland zoning under one key requirement in shoreland zoning. Typically, in shoreland zoning, development within the shoreland zone is limited to 20% development coverage, so 20% of a lot can be covered by a building, driveway, development, impervious area. In certain cases, DEP will accept other percentages if the town demonstrates that a historical kind of pattern is different, and we were able to do that at Higgins Beach. At Higgins Beach, the average development coverage is about 35%. We did a pretty exhaustive sort of analysis to demonstrate that. And so that's what's being proposed under shoreland zoning change, is to change that from 20 to 35. And DEP is aware of that, and they're supportive of that change based on what we've provided them. And what that can do is that can kind of remove that 20% constraint that can enable there's a few undeveloped lots at Higgins Beach. Instead of being limited to 20, they can be developed at 35%. There's also some properties that might be developed at lesser percentage than 35 that would have to stick with whatever their percentage is today. In this provision, they can benefit from the average. And so that also helps with folks, again, adding on and developing in a way that's consistent with the proposed zoning. So in a nutshell, that's kind of where we're at. And I can get into more details if the council has questions here tonight. And again, at future meetings, we can do, you know, a longer presentation, particularly for the new councilors, if the council would like me to do that. So.
Thank you, Jim. Again, is there any questions, Dan, at this time? All right. Well, I do just want to say the fact that there is not a packed room full of angry people speaks volumes of how well you handled everything and an outstanding job with outreach and really trying to understand what the unique issues were down there. And if I'm not mistaken, you guys will be doing a similar exercise next summer down with Pine Point. So, well, thank you. And so we have back to our first part of this here, which is our order is 15-084. So that is a first reading and schedule a planning board public hearing. Is there anybody that wanted to speak on this item? And yep, go right ahead, head up to the podium, name, address, and you have a three minutes to speak.
I'm Walter Wilson from Design Company in Saco, and I do a lot of work at Higgins Beach and in Saco, and I've done over 50 projects at Higgins Beach so far. I recognize that the biggest problem they have with getting things approved is going through the ZBA is because of setbacks, side, front, and rear. I'd like to just say a couple things about the ordinance. I'm in favor of reducing the setbacks, no question. But the ordinance increases the setback on the rear yard from 15 feet to 30 feet. That will make a majority of the houses at Higgins Beach non-conforming just on the rear yard setback. It also changes the height definition, how you measure the height of the building. That in itself will also make a lot of houses non-conforming. Excuse me. And the way I look at the ordinance, the way it starts out, it's going to open up an administrative review of everything that requires a building permit. And when I asked Dan and Brian what the administrative review would be, he said it'd be setting up a board not consisting of the zoning board to review all applications. Well, that kind of bothers me a little bit, because now no matter what you do for a building permit, you have to go through administrative review board. And the ordinance does not say how it's to be set up, how it's supposed to, what rules the governance is supposed to use, or what the appeals from that are. So that's adding more overlays onto Higgins Beach, even if you're just taking and adding a small addition to an existing house that meets all the setbacks, you still have to get an administrative review for compliance of the ordinance. I find that to be a problem. The other thing, going through it, I've actually handwritten 23 pages of things I'd like to discuss about it, but we're limited, so I can't talk about that tonight. The other aspect about this ordinance, it determines what size of house you can have. It gives you three different types of houses that you can use. We aren't talking a community that's in an association or a condominium. We're talking private landowners on public streets. And this ordinance creates almost a condominium or association building restrictions on your private property. I don't find that to be a correct way of a town to tell its people on a public street, on a private piece of property of their own, what size and shape of house they should have. Now, I discussed this with the planning department and so forth, and the way they construct these buildings is you start with a certain size box and you're only allowed to add certain types of components to it. And you're going to end up with a bunch of boxes down there. The character of Higgins Beach is that it's diverse. And this is trying to make it a dead style of building, basically, as far as I can understand it. You're going to lose the flair of Higgins Beach by having these type of buildings. It says that one of the buildings you can use is a bungalow. My company has done over 5,000 living units. I've done two bungalows. And that was back in the 60s. Now, if people wanted to build a bungalow house, they'd be building the Higgins Beach on these houses that are being built. They aren't building bungalows because no one wants them anymore. The cottage house limits the size of the house to 18 feet wide and 36 feet long. No one builds a house 18 foot by 36 feet long. And you don't see them being built at Higgins Beach today on the ones that are getting rebuilt. So I think the council should take and look at this to understand what it's trying to do. It's trying to give some relief on side yard setbacks and front yard setbacks, which I agree to, but then it's trying to limit whether even an establishment of an administrative review board to discuss the design of a house that a person could put in his own private lot. And I don't think that's right. So if there is a workshop that's going to be done that I could address some of these other concerns I have, I'd be more than happy to come and discuss them with you. So with that.
Dan is certainly most capable to answer the questions are raised.
Dan, would you mind jumping back up and maybe just answering, which you, I realize on the spot, but answering what questions you can and... perhaps too, if you'd, I didn't
Dan's
quite catch the gentleman's name, but
Dan's familiar with these.
I think it was Walter Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Yes. If you wanted to also just forward your questions over to town staff, and we'll work on getting some of the answers to you.
Sure.
Yeah, in terms of, I don't have all the comments written down, but a few of them. In terms of administrative review, that's entirely going to consist of review that's typical of a building permit process, but it would likely include the zoning administrator and code enforcement officer, zoning administrator, planner. So it's a staff review within our department. So it's not a planning board, long-range planning committee, zoning board review process. It's a process that's not unlike getting a building permit where there's review by a few different staff versus just one building inspector. So it's not intended to be a an overly rigorous process. It's intended to put a few staff members together to review the code and see how an application complies. And if there are issues where it doesn't comply, we work with an applicant to kind of get through those. So I think that was one of the questions. In terms of building height, that was a pretty big concern in the Higgins Beach community. There's already a variety of building height limitations in the shoreline zone. Buildings are limited to 35 to the peak, to a top of a house, when in the other part of Higgins Beach that isn't restricted by shoreline zoning, it's the current zoning says 35 feet, but that's measured halfway up a roof, so from between a peak and an eave. So the proposal in the code is trying to compromise, and it proposes that the maximum height be 32 feet measured the way the town measures. So 32 feet between the peak and an eave of a roof, trying to step the heights down a little bit to be a bit more equitable where the property is in the shoreline zone, principally because when you have very small lots, and new houses are built that are trying to take advantage of the height limitation or the maximum height allowance, there can be a fair amount of shadowing or scale issues, where a house can be tall and slender, towering over a house that's maybe a story and a half. So that was deliberate to be a bit more restrictive on height to provide more kind of uniformity at Higgins Beach. At the workshop, as part of the presentation that I did back on October 7th, we did provide one slide that showed how the code's trying to be style neutral or allow a variety of housing sort of styles. The code does certainly, the way it's put together with diagrams and with sketches, trying to help applicants understand what the code means. That can also kind of hurt in terms of interpretation, because people may think that I have to build a house that looks exactly like this farmhouse in the code. So that's not the requirement. You're not required to build like the pictures in the code. You're required to comply with the standards that give examples as to how you build that way. But we can provide more examples to the council at a future meeting that kind of shows you could do this architecture, you can do that architecture. They both meet the code. They look very different, but they're of the same kind of proportions. It's more about proportions, proximity to property lines, those types of things. And I think one of the other kind of questions or concerns was setbacks, especially a rear setback. We are, under the code, proposing to have a greater rear setback for principal buildings, so the house, for new construction in particular. And that's by design in that at Higgins Beach, most all the older homes are close to the street when they didn't have to play by the current zoning rules, because the current zoning is interfering with this. But most older cottages and homes are, you know, in the 8 to 20 feet from the front property line range. And so part of the lot standards proposed here are trying to encourage that to continue, where new houses are built closer to the street, that they have some backyard space, and that they aren't overly long, so they're not taking up the entire lot. That's one of the current challenges at Higgins Beach is... Is that my time's up, or?
You're holding out.
The timer.
Where's the link, man? Come on.
So yeah, the rear setback requirement is deliberate in that trying to get houses closer to the street and not consuming the entire length of a lot. There is an allowance for rear additions to kind of go up to that rear setback, and there's an allowance for smaller outbuildings to be in that rear yard where you would customarily see them, such as an accessory unit or a small garage can be in that rear setback. So that's a couple of responses to some of the concerns, and we certainly can continue to kind of work through what we hear as we go along to get this right, so.
Thank you, Mr. Bacon. So, we are on order number 15-084, at this point, we will need a motion.
So moved.
Second.
We have a first and a second, and discussion. Jean Marie.
Yeah, I was a member of the Long Range Planning Committee that has taken a good look at this, and regretfully, I was unable to make the charrette just because of my travel schedules, but that's the way it worked out. But all the feedback we've had from the community at Higgins Beach and from the vetting that went on in Long Range Planning was very positive about this. And again, this is just the first reading, and it's to schedule the planning board hearing. And really, the planning board is the place for a lot of the questions that you may have, Mr. Wilson. And I support this. So.
Thank you, Jim Murray. And Councilor Bayline?
I just want to, so I do appreciate citizen input in any of these, especially in areas in which I don't have a strong background in this type of particular ordinance. I don't, so I do rely especially on the expertise of the planning board. So this is the first reading, and it's going to the planning board, who are the experts. But I do think it's important to recognize that it's my understanding that the comments that have been made and the 23 pages of questions may have already been vetted by the community participants, and they're actually supportive of the changes. And for me, the fact that the community is supportive of the changes speaks volumes to how I proceed forward, especially given the impact that this has. But at the same time, I do look at this really as a long-term situation, because this is really the framework for how we're then going to approach Pine Point. And I look at it from the larger perspective, and I think that this is appropriate when you then compare what is necessary in the Pine Point area.
Mm-hmm.
And extrapolate that out a little bit. So I do appreciate all the work that Long Range Vision, Planning Department, and everyone that's, that has put into this. So I do appreciate that work, and I'll support it.
Thank you. Bill.
I attended virtually all of the charrette meetings in the summer, the fall follow-up meeting at which there was very substantial involvement and participation by the community. Mr. Wilson was there and was virtually the only person actually to speak not in favor of the ordinance. As best I can tell from speaking with many, many people in the community, this is widely supported. In the last couple of weeks since the ordinance draft came out, Councillor Blaze and I have made an effort to try and get further input from community leaders who are getting input from others as to any concerns or questions. There were a whole series of questions that I went to Dan Bacon with to get answers to get clarifications on, particularly on the commercial, the scope of the commercial zone, as well as others, height clarifications. There's very strong support for the height limitations. The community does not favor the kind of towers that are being built with the setbacks that are presently imposed. The sort of reduced scale porch, whether it's enclosed and used as interior space or open air, which is characteristic of Higgins Beach, is very much favored to reduce the height impact, which still can be, I think, as high as 32 feet. So the rear yard setback issue, there is an accessory building for a cottage or a garage in the rear of the building that is allowed to be 8 feet from the rear lot setback, so that the space in the backyard is intended to still allow viewing avenues through the backyards, but the backyard can still be used as a garage or a
small cottage apartment, limited to 1.5 stories. And so it's a very nice compromise of use of space in the backyard. So all in all, the people who I spoke to, who were a number of community leaders out there, said their questions were answered. They felt very confident that they understood it, and it was a direction that the community wanted to see us move.
Thank you. Anybody else? Councillor Blaze.
I agree with what Bill said. I think the whole process has been outstanding. We got an awful lot of feedback from people that live in the community. Initially, when they came out, and just the original charrettes back in June, we sat down and looked at different types of communities across the country. We went on walks around the community, took a look at the different buildings types. Everybody was very, very impressed with the whole process. Mm-hmm. And I think that perhaps is the most important thing. The process itself was very, very successful. The resultant ordinance has raised a number of questions. But the public hearings that we'll have at the planning board should answer most of those questions. I think a lot of the questions have already been brought back to Dan and the planning department to take a look at. So I think that this is going to be an outstanding new ordinance for the community and should be very, very successful. Thank you.
All right, so on to me. Generally speaking, it sounds like the process was fairly good. There was a lot of outreach. There was a lot of kind of pull in from the community itself. Certainly, there's maybe, you know, questions that have maybe someone missed, or certainly now that they've had some time to settle and have all the, you know, when you get the zoning ordinances and you tangibly get them in front of you, they tend to be quite long and wordy and complex, and then when you finally see it in print, you know, conceptually you hear it and then you see it in print, you know, it can trigger a few questions, and Lord knows I've caught a typo along the way once or twice, so I mean, certainly, you know, those things go on. Given that it's first reading, it's certainly pretty early in our process. It's first reading, we're referring to planning board, which will have its own separate process, and then it needs to come back. So hopefully, again, you know, any questions that are around, those can be addressed or at least answered. Maybe it's not a solution, but at least an answer to any question that may come forward. But again, I'm sure town staff will be more than happy to try to assist with that. So again, just to recap for myself, being first reading, I will gladly support it, and hopefully everything can be kind of worked out, and I think it is overall a good step forward. So, any other discussion? Seeing none. All right, all those in favor? And that is unanimous. On to our next item is Order 15-085 is the first reading, and schedule a planning board public hearing on the proposed amendments to the Town of Scarborough official zoning map to delineate the Higgins Beach character districts. Again, this is a first reading. Would anybody like to speak on this order? And by all means, please go ahead and come to the podium. State your name, address for the public record, and you do have 3 minutes.
Maureen Sayer, 4 White Sands Lane at Higgins Beach. I just wanted to point out, I attended just, I think, all but one of the meetings, and I know did an amazing job, but there are some concerns I have and some other people have too about the feeling that I have, and I'm not sure if it's true, that we must do certain things. For example, the front porch. I love front porches. However, I love sunlight, and we all know a porch in the front darkens your interior, and the current house has a wraparound windows.
So I don't want to lose light, even if I did any type of a renovation. In shoreland, I'm not sure what I can do. But the other piece is there are some notations in there about fenestrations. And it does appear that that the windows are set at certain set intervals. Now, I may be wrong about that. I haven't a chance to ask it. But for example, a bank of windows, as I have, may be something that they don't promote, and that where people may want to put windows in their home may not be where it is allowable. And if you note in the drawings that are there, that just about all the houses have porches, which I think is super friendly. We'd all love to have more land, and then that's great. And then the other, but I personally have struggled with, do I even ever want a porch? This is before this even came up. But to be told you must have it if you're doing this, if you're renovating, which is the way it feels, then I'm not sure if that's correct, because as Walter said, it is our private property. And then, and as much as we all would like more...
Can I interrupt you for just one moment, please?
Yes.
You do realize we're on order number 15-085?
No, I don't know that.
Oh. this pertains to changing the zoning map, so it demonstrates where the zoning is.
I didn't get in before, so I'll just wrap it up. I'm interested in the zoning because I'm in the shoreland. And but there are some things in there that are concerning, wherever we can put these accessory buildings in the back. But at one of the last meetings I went to, someone said, well, what if we have a row of four very tall houses with side setbacks are going to be larger, so they're closer together, then you have these dotted buildings in the backyard. Is that really going to look good? It's fine if there's only a couple, but if there's a whole row of them. I don't know. So there's a lot to think about in the overall final impact. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry to be so ignorant.
No, you're fine. So again, just to recap, we're having the first reading and schedule a planning board public hearing on the proposed amendment to the Town of Scarborough official zoning map to delineate the Higgins Beach Character District. So again, does anybody wish to speak on this item for the map rezoning? Please rise to the podium, state your name and address, and you do have 3 minutes.
Yes, Walter Wilson again from Design Company. The delineation of the character districts on the map, is that going to actually change the name of the zone from R4 to the character district?
Yes.
It's going to change the name. In the Scarborough Charter for zoning amendments and writings, does that require a public referendum on that, or does the council do that by charter? If you're changing the zoning ordinance.
I don't believe the charter at all limits the council's ability to do many things, including land use zoning.
Okay, I didn't know if it had to go to public referendum or not.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The delineation of the character districts at Higgins Beach, when they are changed to the locations that are specified, like you mentioned, this is going to be a base thing for other ocean communities in the town. So does that mean that the other communities that may undergo a review of this will also be changing their zoning designations to something else, like this map is going to be done at Higgins Beach?
It's possible.
Potentially, sure.
Okay. So the reallocation of a changing from the R4 to this type of district within the is within the council's ability to do without going to a public vote. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. Just wanted to verify that. Thank you.
You're welcome. Does anybody else wish to speak? All right. Seeing none, I will close the public comment and pleasure of the council.
So moved.
Approval. Second.
So we have a first and a second. Is there any discussion on the zoning maps? All right. Seeing none, all those in favor of first reading and referring to public planning board, and that is unanimous. On to our next item is order number 15-086, first reading and schedule a planning board public hearing on the proposed amendments to Chapter 405C, the Town of Scarborough Shoreland Zoning Ordinance,
to address the development coverage allowance in the Higgins Beach area. Again, would you just quickly recap, it was changing the shoreline zone from 20% to 35% of the coverage area on the lot, if I'm not mistaken.
That's correct, and the planning department has negotiated or sought and received approval from DEP for that lot, that variance, if you will.
All right, and is there anybody that wishes to speak on this item? The podium, name, address, in 3 minutes.
Yeah, Walt Wilson Design Company again. Yeah, I just actually heard about this tonight, changing it to 35%, which I think is a good idea. I think a lot of stuff I agree with this is a good idea. I just don't like the design of the building limitations. Right now, you're allowed 20% in the shoreline zoning for building coverage, with another 20% for impervious and lot improvements for a maximum of about 40%. The 35%, I'd like to know what that represents. Is that structural coverage, or is that the inclusion of the impervious areas and so forth as well?
Dan, could you answer that question, please? Thank you. Dan Bacon, town planner.
Sure. Shoreland zoning in Scarborough and most communities in the state limits development coverage to 20%. So that's all development on a property within the shoreland zone. So that's buildings, parking, driveways. And the proposal is to change that 20% overall development coverage limitation to 35% development coverage limitation. So there are other zones in town, non-shoreland zones, where we may limit just building coverage, or we may limit building coverage and lot coverage, and maybe the percentages Walt's referring to. But under shoreland zoning, it's 20% development coverage, shifting to 35% development coverage.
Thank you, Dan. Does anybody else wish to speak on this item? All right, seeing none, I will close public comment. Pleasure of the council.
So moved.
So first and a second, is there any discussion?
Good job by Dan Bacon to get DEP to agree to 35%. This is another advancement for all people in the shoreland zone, another valuable addition to the zoning.
And there you go. All right, all those in favor? And that is unanimous to refer to the planning board. Order number 15-087, Act on the Review of the Dangerous Building located at 9 Partridge Lane, and authorize the town manager to schedule a public hearing pursuant to 17 MRSA 2581. And we do have a Brian Lonsdale here from staff to introduce what's going on with 9 Partridge Lane.
The terrible saga of 9 Partridge Lane. We started receiving complaints about 9 Partridge Lane well over a year ago. We began our process where we write a notice of violation, or actually write a letter requesting an opportunity to speak with the property owner. Our letters were returned. They weren't received. We got no response from the homeowner. So then we took another step and got an administrative warrant from the court to actually physically go in and inspect the property, at which time we determined that it was, in fact, uninhabitable. It was unsanitary. I can't even really describe the conditions we found inside. So it was bad. And we had the health officer there. We had the local police department there. So we placarded the building with condemned notices on it, and once again, we returned that administrative warrant to the court with our findings. We got a copy of that. We sent it to the property owner, no response. So now that some time has gone by, we intended to get this in front of you earlier, but it didn't get there. So we're now asking, at the advice of the town's attorney, we're asking the council to set a public hearing. We would then have to serve the property owner and any parties in kind mortgage holders, that type of thing. We would serve them with a notice letting them know about the public hearing, when it was scheduled, and what your job as council would be is then to hold that public hearing and determine from the testimony and the evidence heard what we should do with that building. And it may be, you may feel like it needs to be demolished. You may feel like there's some other remedy that you would pursue. That's the purpose of the public hearing under the Dangerous Building Act.
And since you're here and handy, our next item is another dangerous building located at 2 Ashland Drive. Would you mind just thinking about that one, too?
It has been the year of dangerous buildings. 2 Ashland Drive, again, we started receiving some complaints about this property around a year ago. We coordinated with the police department and learned that they'd responded to some 64 complaints over a three or four-year period at that residence. The owner or current occupant does suffer from mental illness and some other problems and issues, and the property was in pretty bad repair. We kind of followed the same process. We actually hand-delivered a request to inspect to Mr. Chappell, the current resident. He allowed us to enter the structure. We entered with the local health officer and Sergeant John O'Malley and myself and one other code enforcement officer. And again, the conditions inside the home were pretty sad. No working facilities, unsanitary, trash piled high, you couldn't find the sinks, it was in bad shape. And there are a few photos, I think, in your packet that just to give you a little flavor of what we found. So pretty sad conditions. Again, in this case, we wanted to try to find some resources to help Mr. Chappell because of his condition. So we took a little bit of time, rather than to immediately placard the house, we took a little bit of time to try to do some research and find a place for him to be, where he could get some help. We kind of struck out on that. We searched high and low, and there weren't really any available resources. We felt the only thing we could do at that point was to ask him to vacate the premises and deem it uninhabitable and put the placards on it and try to kind of break the cycle. He'd been basically squatting in the house for years. So we also simultaneously learned that the mortgage lender was going to foreclose on the property, and as we understand it, a sale has been scheduled for December. So unlike the 9 Partridge Lane, at the advice and suggestion and recommendation of the town's attorney, on this property, because of the pending sale of the property, he felt it was prudent for the town to go directly to Superior Court, which is an avenue allowed under the Dangerous Building Act. You can go directly to Superior Court and file your complaint there, and that way it gets attached to the property and not just as a building violation to the owner.
Right.
The owner, you know, he's a persona non grata at this point. He's not there. We don't know where he is actually at this point. So if we get it attached to the property, it allows the town to recover its costs. We actually boarded up the structure, spent about $1,100 in materials and town staff time to do that in order to keep Mr. Chappell from re-entering the property at his own peril. So we can recoup our costs, and the court can also determine what remedy for that building should be done. We're actually hoping that the mortgage company will come to the table and we'll get a consent agreement out of them, and it will be corrected before it even goes to sale. That's our hope once we place this on there. So our ask is for you, the council, to allow the town manager and myself with the town's attorney to take this to Superior Court and pursue it through those avenues.
Mm-hmm. Great. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
So we're on the first one, which is order number 15-087. Which is 9 Partridge Lane. Act on the review of a dangerous building located at 9 Partridge Lane and authorize the town manager to schedule a public hearing pursuant to 17 MRSA 2581. Does anybody want to speak on this item? And seeing none, I will close comment. Pleasure of the council.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion?
Mm-mm.
All right. Seeing none, all those in favor, and that is unanimous. On to the next one, order number 15-088, act to authorize the town manager and zoning administrator to pursue legal proceedings to abate the conditions of the dangerous building located at 2 Aslan Drive pursuant to 17 MRSA 2581. Does anybody wish to speak on this item? And seeing none, I will close comment and pleasure of the council.
So moved.
Second.
We have a first and a second. Any discussion? Jean Marie.
I happen to be familiar with the gentleman who lived or whatever at 2 Aslan Drive just because I drive by him every day and I just knew where he was and some of the neighbors and whatever. So I want to thank the town for at least trying to do something about
yeah.
placement and whatnot for him. So I just wanted to say that. So thank you.
Any other discussion? All right, seeing none, all those in favor, and that is unanimous. And on to our last order, which is order number 15-089, act on a request to certify the election results from the main election, from the municipal election, that was held on Tuesday, November 3rd, 2015. And Tody, would you like to take that one away?
We had five candidates for the town council. First, James Benedict received 507 votes. Christopher Cazzo received 2,398 votes. Robert Rowan received 2,149 votes. William Summers, 1,254 votes. Michael Turk, 1,363 votes. The top vote getters were Chris Cazzo and Robert Rowan. For the Board of Education, there were three running for three seats. Donna L. Bealey received 2,843 votes. Catherine Miles received 2,615 votes. Jacqueline Perry received 2,900 votes. We also had a one-year term for the Board of Education. We had one candidate, Carrie Lyford. She received 2,865 votes. For the Sanitary District, there were two seats available to candidates. Nicola Rico received 2,971 votes. Benedetto Viola received 2,973 votes. We had a total of 4,271 voters who cast ballots. There were 1,308 absentee ballots issued, of which 1,242 were returned, and the percentage of voter turnout for this election was 27%.
Very good.
Thank you, Tody Justice. Oh, pleasure of the council.
So moved.
Second. First and second. Any discussion? Oh, congratulations. It's yours at the next one. And any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor. And the vote has been ratified by the council. Item number 8, non-action items. There are none at this time. Item number 9, standing and special committee reports and liaison reports. And we will start down with you, Peter.
Last time I didn't have much to report, but all the liaison groups did meet, so I'll try to do them quickly. Transportation committee met on the 27th. They talked about and reviewed sort of a Gorham Road design update. Also, there was some conversation around trying to take a look at the trailhead of the Eastern Trail as you come off Black Point Road at sort of the end of the Eastern Road and trying to figure out a way if there's a way to get more parking in there. There's kind of a parking situation where there are people that sometimes are turned away during peak time, so they're kind of working on some alternative solutions for that. The Shellfish and Harbor Conservation Committees met on 10/13. For the Shellfish, you know, there was some conversations around really maybe they're interested in seeking some type of moratorium and any type of additional agricultural licenses or expansions until they can really try to figure out some policies and guidelines around that. The Harbor Committee had some really good suggestions, some issues. They did raise that they think there's a real safety issue on the boat ramp as people are backing their boats down. It's really hard to see as the boat goes down over the lip. There's kayakers and others down there, so they expressed some concern about that. As another good thing, as we know, the currents are really moving through a lot of the channels in the town. They also said there's been some real issues with the riptide or currents around the piling, so they were requesting some more signage. Had some questions about moorings and access to moorings. How's that determined? Again, the conversation about red seaweed came up and what impact that's having on sort of the front side of the beaches. Talked about there's some real work for the docks and cleats and cranes need some attention. It raised some questions about how the commercial licenses are granted for the commercial use, rental of kayaks and other things. So that was sort of a summary of that group. Seniors met on 10/20, and we had talked about it in our workshop. They're really starting to become a much more activated group, and they're really trying to look at, is there a way to get more facility time in Scarborough, whether it's the schools or other things to do activities. They're really trying to say that so far, I mean, in the past, a lot of the activities have been towards seniors that like to go on tours and doing other things. They're saying there's a real need now that seniors and the sort of young seniors wanting to be active. Conversations around pickleball and horseshoes and some other things, so they're really starting to get engaged. They talked a little bit about there is and I think it's official, they've hired a new program coordinator that's come on board, Ed Mann, so they talked a little bit about that, and it's the official title is Youth and Senior Citizen Program Coordinator, and they had some conversations around that. So I think that summarizes the groups that I was associated with. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Blake.
Last Monday there was a planning board meeting, and at that meeting the second cell tower in a residential area was approved.
Very good.
Once again, the planning board did an outstanding job of investigating it, asking all sorts of questions, making the applicant perform tests, and I think they were very pleased with the outcome. After the meeting, out in the parking lot, two of the members of the planning board did approach me, and they asked me whether it would be possible for the planning board to review the ordinance with either the ordinance committee or the town council. They felt that there were a couple things in the ordinance that needed clarification. So I've got those items. I will forward those to Jean Marie.
Yep.
And Kate.
Staff as well, please.
And you. Okay.
Yep.
Me, just real short and sweet. Historic Preservation met last night. What they were currently working on was just site visits and verification of the adopted list, 48 properties. We also have some exciting news, which I'm sure Tom's going to talk to a little bit in his manager comments, but we've seen some great progress with the Danish Village Arch.
That is on my list.
It is on your list. I have still all your thunder. And I do just have a slight little bit of not so great news, the Hunnewa House. Our little friends, the Powder Post Beetles, aren't quite gone. So we will be, staff will be working diligently for an additional treatment this spring. But they're certainly quite diminished, but they're not gone. So they'll need to be handled again. The next meeting for Historic Preservation is December 1st. And I was fortunate enough to be appointed to that committee, not in my capacity as a counselor, but as a private citizen. So probably haven't seen the last of me. I might be standing at that spot over there, but you might not have seen the last of me anyway for historic preservation. Do you mind?
I really don't have anything, well, because I haven't been able to go to Conservation Commission because I'm taking classes on Monday nights, but they are working on a composting workshop they're going to do on April, which I think will be interesting for the community. And then long-range planning I also missed because I was in Chicago. What could I say? So, sorry. Next.
Energy Committee met on October 21st. I think I'll let Tom speak to the TriGen status since there's some very exciting news about that. The
Energy Committee has spent a lot of time talking about the whole issue of what improvements in the trash, the municipal solid waste issue that we tossed their way after the pay-as-you-throw bag thing really was not favored, was widely not favored. So there's a little bit of running out of gas, I think, that we've perceived on it. So Deb McDonough, who is enthusiastic about it still, about the analysis, Tom and I have taken on the responsibility to try and push it over a report over the line to try and pull this together. We're planning meetings, and we're doing research on what our options are. There are some aggressive proposals that would be interesting, whether we can actually get to that stage. But we will demonstrate where savings can actually be made and improvements in each of those particular areas. So I think the report will be informative. The Rules Committee met on the allocation policy for charitable contributions. We really narrowed the focus to Scarborough organizations, and we will have a rule completed for that. And I think that's all the committees I went to. Yeah.
Thank you, Bill. Councillor Mabine.
Thank you. Just as an auxiliary benefit, because I do serve on the Cumberland County Budget Advisory Committee, we've actually completed our work on that committee for the year. Just to give you a precursor, the committee's recommendation is to actually accept their manager's budget, which actually increases their requirements by 2.94%. So without, because the assessments are not known across the board for all 28 communities, it's very difficult to determine at this particular stage until probably January, February, what the impact is to Scarborough. But I do want to at least express, and I'll provide some details to you later on what that is, because I think that we need to be more involved as a leader in that. And all I have to suggest to my friends who are part of that, which includes several Scarborough residents, if you think we have a broken process here, you want to participate with that process, especially when you're dealing with other communities and trying to find a common approach to budgeting. Outside of that, keeping in line with finances, I do want to actually hand out two handouts for you. The most recent Finance Committee took up two items. The first item that I'll pass out is the outside agency allocations. If you recall, during the budget cycle last year, we were instructed to determine an appropriate process in which we allocate our, what I call outside, or what we call outside agencies, or other services, social services to other agencies. We originally had budgeted, I believe, $60,000. We provide a detailed line item approach to those organizations that we have approved at the committee level. So this is more of a notification and not an action item, in which, based upon the new formula and the new process that has been signed off on, we're allocating $53,442, leaving a net surplus or savings, in essence, of $6,558. Which the council can determine at a later time how it wishes to allocate that to balance the budget, which might be a good segue into allocating that to the affordable tax senior maybe account that we talked about earlier, having a slush into that account to get it started. I mean, there's all kinds of opportunities that you could have with that. Heck, you might even put it towards meters. So, but I wanted to at least provide the information. Sorry, I had to editorialize on that one.
Yeah,
I just had to. You know me. So those are there for you to review. And I do appreciate the Finance Committee's work on this. You know, Peter and Bill were very instrumental in setting that forward, and so I appreciate that. The next item I want to provide is actually an up-to-date financial statements for you. What we have done, and I do want to commend the town manager and Ruth Porter, our finance director, in the presentation. It's a more succinct, I think, approach than we've taken in the past, what I would call a more executive level, you know, because it is an interim statement, It is unaudited, it is internal, which provides a year-to-date observation in comparison to the same year-to-date as prior years, both from an appropriation level as well as an expended level, and then a percentage that has been allocated or used for the year and how that trends. The one significant difference this year is that Ruth has been kind with her staff to really provide footnotes at the bottom to kind of explain some of the deviations
mm-hmm.
that kind of stuck out to us that we identified and said, can you at least give us some type of footnote that says this is why that happened? I do want to point out on page one, which is the balance sheet, you know, being in finance, I got to tell you that this is a very strong organization. It's a very stable organization, and it's sustainable. Total assets over the period from September 30th of 2014 to the same time this year increased $3.9 million, while liabilities only increased $2.4 million. That gave us a net increase of fund balance of about $1.5 million.
Uh-huh.
That is a positive trend. It's primarily allocated, as you can see, in the cash bucket. It's about $1.1 million in cash alone. Some of that has to deal with the current economic cycle that we're dealing with that is much better. I think that one thing that we don't have available today for you to kind of compare this to is where was the fiscal year end, too, because you'll see that Tom and Dr. Entwistle and the school department really did a stellar job in managing our money and has a very different outcome than what was originally projected, which was a little bit of a doom and gloom. And it's a very different outcome that's very strong and very positive. So this just kind of ties into, I think, the total economic trend and the economic recovery that we're experiencing locally, but also statewide in other communities. So just take a look at the other areas. I'm not going to go through each of the items. This will be available. I believe Tom is going to make sure that it's available for anybody that wants a copy of it. Again, I think it's a very strong performance record for us, and it speaks volumes to the financial acumen that we have with all of our managers. That is my report.
Next item number 10, town manager report.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. A couple quick things. Construction projects, we're wrapping up all of our road work. Transportation Committee has been dealing with a number of things, but taking advantage of the good weather, and it's working out well in that regard. One of those projects is the relocation of the Danish Arch from its original location down on Route 1 and Lincoln Avenue, I guess, the location of the Danish village itself. The relocation was accomplished about 10 days ago, and it's been placed right here in Memorial Park behind us. It didn't go exactly as planned in that we weren't able to move it fully intact, and so they had to actually saw it off some distance up from the ground. And what you're seeing now is they're actually building brick piers up to that location, and then we'll rest the original part back down on it. So everything's going as planned. The next phase, once the mason has done that work, will be to repair the roof, which is in pretty hard shape. There's very unique tin roof, but underneath that there's a wood substructure that's totally degraded that needs to be replaced. We also plan to electrify it. We're able to find as close to a period lantern as we could. And so we really think it will be a nice statement piece visible from Sawyer Road and across the park, given where it's situated. I'm pleased to mention the HR department registered the town in a state and federal program. It's a Hire a Vet campaign. It's done through the Department of Labor and the U.S. Veterans Affairs Department. Scarborough has the unique and distinct recognition of being, one, the first municipality to sign up for the program, and two, the first to hire a vet. So we were recognized and very pleased to be part of that program. Our newest hire for which we got this recognition is actually in our IT department and doing a great job. As was mentioned earlier, we are finally to the point of dedicating and cutting a ribbon for our tri-generation facility here at the back of Town Hall. Press release was sent out, and that dedication ceremony is scheduled for next Tuesday, November 10, at 11:30 in the morning. And there'll be a few words from myself. I believe Councilor Donovan is liaison to the Energy Committee, will be part of that program, as will our Energy Committee Chair. And we'll have folks around to give tours such and answer questions, perhaps will be more important and appropriate. So we're very pleased. It's been years in the making. Very pleased to finally reach this time. Also, just to put on your calendar, there is an e-waste recycling or collection day. It'll be here at Scarborough High School parking lot right behind us, November 14th from 9 to 2. This is free, although they do have cash donations to the Band Booster Club. And it's amazing, the sort of stuff. And I encourage you all, look through your attics and your basements. You have a lot of this stuff, whether you know it or not. TVs, computers, monitors, CPUs, all of that stuff.
Oh, yeah.
It's a great way to cleanse. And it's also certainly suggested that you provide a nominal donation to the Band Boosters in doing so. And lastly, I want to congratulate the two newly elected councilors. Apparently, they're eager to take office. They're with us this evening. I have contacted both and are scheduled to meet next week to begin the process, even before they're sworn in, of getting acclimated. So I very much look forward to that. And I would be remiss not to certainly recognize the outgoing councilors. Councilor Blaze, it's been a pleasure. You've always been a gentleman, and always appreciate, as was mentioned earlier, your adherence to your values. I always had a full appreciation where you stood, and that's a lot. I say that somewhat jokingly, but I that's a tremendous trait of yours, and I have appreciated working with you. And to Councilor Holbrook, it's been a pleasure. It's been two terms. We've had the occasion to work, do a ton of committee work together, and certainly work closely this year, and I have to commend you. You have grown tremendously during your time on council, and as was mentioned in the goal setting, you should be proud of your service. You have a couple of really important accomplishments you can take credit for. So it's been a pleasure, and I hope neither of you are strangers. There's plenty of work to be done, and we'd love to have you back. Perhaps our zoning board. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Tom. So we'll right into item number 11, council member comments, and we'll start on that end, so we'll go with the sentence for that.
Excellent. So much to talk about, and so don't do it. So little to talk about in so much time, Willy Wonka, right? So first, time flies by really fast. I just actually celebrated this past week my 18th anniversary with my wife, and I've realized that I spent 10 of those years actually sitting in a council chamber. So I'm very fortunate to have a partner. And with that in mind, I do want to congratulate not only the two people who are going to be serving with us, but also their families, and thanking them for allowing you to serve, because it is a family commitment. It can also be a family burden. I really want to thank all of the candidates that ran in all of the races. It takes a lot to step forward. It takes a lot of courage to put yourself out there and to accept the criticism. The funny thing is, in this job, fact is that you're yelled at, you're more often than not shunned, and you're very rarely thanked. So I hope, if anything, this might be the only time that you ever get thanked for your service. But I want to say thank you, and especially to Mr. Ciazzo, he was coming over from the school board, and his service on the school board is very much appreciated for the last 3 years, and especially having worked with him on the finance side. Did want to mention, I hate saying goodbye, so as I mentioned on at least social media, I'm going to at least say until next time. Councilor Blake, you are the quintessential gentleman. You have done a stellar job. I would call you, if it wasn't such an oxymoron, I'd call you the lion of the council. However, you don't necessarily have to speak very loudly to be impactful and to be effective, and I want to say thank you for doing that, because one of the things is that are probably polar opposites in just about every social policy, fiscal policy, definitely fiscal policy, that you can derive, but yet it has been very nice to listen to your perspective, because it is something that is very important to this community, and I do appreciate everything that you've done, and I wish I was able to have served more than this past year with you, because it has been a wonderful experience. So thank you and your wife and family for allowing you to do that. Ms. Holbrook.
I didn't do it.
You didn't do it. You were a pain in the tuckus when you came in, and you're still a pain in the tuckus. But you know what? You have been an incredible counselor, and I want you to know that the flowers are actually from all of us to you. I was taught in my family by a very good grandfather. It was not my great-grandfather, but he's a great-grandfather, that gentlemen who deserve respect get a great handshake, and you will get one, sir. And ladies get flowers, so I want you to know that the flowers are from all of us, because you have represented this council and each of us in a very unique way that has balanced what I would call disparate agendas that can be challenging. And you have been respectful to all of us. You have been a calming presence for several conflicts with certain citizens that have come forward and spoken when they're not supposed to, or misbehaved, if that's the best way to explain it. And I think that you have done that as a gentle lady, and I do appreciate what you have done. And I think whoever steps into or sits into that seat better be prepared to fill those high heel shoes that you've worn with the camouflage that you're wearing tonight.
I have to.
I just want to, you know, you're the only person outside of Ms. Perry on the school board. You're the only person in which I've served more than 1 year with. And so I had the pleasure of serving with you the first 2 years that you served when you first came on. Mm-hmm. So I'm starting to feel a little old. Definitely not outdated and unwanted yet, but I do want to say thank you. And to the sense of being tacky, you know, I don't know whether or not you've grown or simply have gotten used to doing the job so well that you've done, but you've done an extremely good job, and I do appreciate that. You know, over the past, and this kind of ties into my next thing, you know, over the past couple of days, there's been a lot of reflection and a lot of comments about campaigns and things that have happened on people's campaigns. And there's been references to elitism and whatever the term might be that I think are kind of inappropriate given the environment, because it should be a celebratory environment when people step forward to volunteer. You know, I figured it out. I've actually served with 21 different counselors over my tenure since 2000. Mm. And I think it was, and 8 of them have been women. And, you know, the best counselors I have worked with have did everything from a PhD candidate to a hairstylist and a clam digger. And the fact is that regardless of any background, your contribution to the community is valuable, and it represents a true community position. So I want to say thank you to you and your family, especially I know your husband is here, and say thank you to you. God knows he's probably happy, but because it does take a lot, and I do appreciate that. The other item, I do want to actually, a couple of quick comments with the elections. Toadie, awesome job.
Thank you.
Every year you do an incredible job with the staff that you have, with the volunteers, with the staff. It's a smooth and wonderful experience to go through the gauntlet, no matter how many politicians are standing there to shake your hand, and then to walk in with all the smiling faces at the table and the efficient responses that we get at the end of the night. Scarborough is highly respected because of the work that you do, and I do appreciate everything that you and your staff do. Also along with those who stay behind and have to keep the doors open here, because that matters as well. So thank you very much for that. And last but not least, it's never too early to remind everybody, adopt a hydrant. Snow's coming. It's getting cold. Adopt a hydrant. Make sure that you know where that is, and that at the very least that is well marked, and that hopefully your family that's closest, or maybe a neighborhood, adopts that and make sure it's kept clean. It's never too early to get started, because I think snow is coming, and I'm really excited about it. So thank you to everyone, and congratulations to our new colleagues.
Mr. Donovan.
Just picking up on your lion reference, I really thought Ed has been really the council's guardian for fiscal responsibility. And it really is important to be reminded of that, because we're always asked to make compromises along the way. And these are, it's nice to have that voice. Our chair, I thought this was a terrific year of leadership by our chair. We are going to lose her expertise in the areas of historic preservation and affordable housing. And that is a real loss on the town council, and we'll need to work to be able to replace that. I'm glad to hear that you are going to be on historic preservation, because that connection to us, a fellow counselor, is really helpful. On that red seaweed, I did meet with Mike Shaw and Tom Hall. It's a very real problem. Mike is working on it. It's elsewhere in southern New England, so we're not the first. It's moving north, and we're going to address it in the budget cycle. And I've told the people that who spoke to us at the last meeting that it would be addressed in the spring. So hopefully help is on the way for Pine Point in that regard. Ed, you might tell us the poll that went up at Broad Turn and Holmes, the approval of the cell tower poll. Was that by a provider that...
Verizon.
And it was, I don't know, 120, 130 feet?
120 feet.
So plenty of room for co-location. So that's going to be real relief. That's the second one approved. A real relief for North and West Scarborough, which was obviously one of the reasons we made the effort we did to get through that. The Planning Department held a public meeting on the Gorham Road transportation analysis. That's really from the library to Payne Road. Jean Marie and Ed also attended that. It was a good turnout, a very active discussion, a lot of concerns, a lot of interest expressed. So in terms of a priority, a project that needs attention, I thought that it was good to be there to hear the people actually identify the issues, some drainage issues, heavy travel issues, inadequate speed controls, bike competition, pedestrian competition. A lot of those issues. I represented us at two ribbon cuttings with Karen Martin, a physical therapy company called OPTA, opened in next door to Hannaford's. And Kenneth Simons was, and his staff were great. Really, it was nice to see that space, which had been vacant for quite some time. Also, the Bella Vita assisted living facility held theirs, and it's a beautiful residential setting, and they really put out a wonderful spread. It was really quite a nice occasion. Everyone enjoyed it. Thank you.
Jean Marie.
I'd like to congratulate the counselors-elect, Chiazzo and Rowan, and also thank everyone who ran for office. It's not easy to run, believe me. I've done it a couple times. Lost one, won one. It's interesting. So thank you for putting yourself out there, and I look forward to working with both of you in the future. God, what can I say? Ed, I'm going to miss you. Again, Ed is the conscience, fiscal conscience of the council. He stuck to his guns, even though I try to get him to change his mind. But, you know, what's really funny, even though he and I came from different polar opposites on a lot of things, he and I actually were able to work for through a lot of Higgins Beach issues. You know, I had one idea here, another, we'd sit and talk, and finally come up to some, you know, good middle ground that finally led to what we've done with the meters. It took a while, but hey, you know, we got something done. And Ed, you're always the consummate gentleman. Even when I call you by mistake at 11:30 at night. Don't ask him about that when his wife wanted to know who was calling him.
Jake from State Farm?
It was one of those, you know, calls that you didn't mean to make. But anyway, Jessica, I have so enjoyed working with you. Please don't be a stranger. You don't live that far away from me.
No, I don't.
Yeah, that's right. I have watched you, you know, being involved as a citizen and then being on the council, and your evolution as a counselor. It's just been amazing to watch. I know that you just have a real class act that you bring to the council table, where you're willing to listen, you keep your cool, which I know is hard sometimes. and have done a great job chairing us this year. You're going to be very missed. And I have a little notation here that I'm sorry to see a sister go. Because, I don't know, Kate and I are stuck with all these guys. I don't know what we're going to do, but anyway, we'll muddle through. We'll talk tomorrow. We'll take care of them.
Right. Oh, yeah.
So thank you.
Ed.
I don't know where to begin. First, I want to thank Tom and all his managers and all the people that work for his managers. It's absolutely incredible bunch of people. And they always were polite and helpful. Did anything that I requested, and I came up with some crazy request at times. I really want to thank you, Tom. And Tom, you were great to just come in and chat with and throw ideas around. I'll continue to do that.
Please do. Thank you.
And my fellow counselors, thank you so much. I have so much respect and admiration for every single one of you. And you've made my tenure on the council extremely enjoyable. And I won't forget that. I won't forget you people either. I'll always be around. I'm sure I'll be in this room many times.
3 minutes.
3 minutes.
Uh-oh.
Jessica, thank you so much. Done a wonderful job this year as chair. You've done a wonderful job the 3 years that I've been working with you. I'm going to really miss working with you, or whatever. and then Chris and Will, congratulations. I think you're going to be a wonderful addition to the council. Good luck to you, and good luck to all of you. Thank you very much.
And Peter.
Yeah, I guess I'll echo everybody's comments, but well, wanted to thank Jessica and Ed for the service they've given and the guidance and other things. So tremendously respect you. Thank you. And welcome Chris and Will, and look forward to working with you.
Stall.
Yeah.
I mean, no. So I do have a couple of off-topic things. The first one is I would like to show everybody, just to, for the folks at home and also for the counselors, because I think this is a wonderful thing to really try to be pushing. Mm-hmm. We do have, through our Scarborough Public Safety, what they call a refrigerator card.
Mm.
And these are basically just a really great tool if you have a loved one that's you know, on a lot of medications and this, you know, some kind of, you know, allergies and those sorts of things. I have all that information right there on the refrigerator that you can just grab and take with you. It's really just phenomenal.
So again, these are through Scarborough Public Safety. It's a great thing. I hate saying that they had a necessary, you know, that this was a need recently, but it really is such a great tool. So there's that. I do just want to say again, kind of tying into that, I'm so happy and excited to hear about, you know, I realize there was a lot of kind of contention around cell towers, and it took us a while to really get through that and try to have something that everyone could reasonably disagree to. I can't express enough how excited I am to hear that we're at a point where there is a cell tower expansion. Something I had brought up at the time, that there are whole areas in that section of town right near me, and you know, right near there actually, where you can be standing there and have absolutely no cell phone signal. And just in this day and age, for 2015, to not be able to dial, you know, 911 if you're in need because your cell phone doesn't work is kind of crazy. So I'm really excited to hear that. That's fantastic news. And I look forward to, never thought I'd look forward to seeing the cell phone tower go up. And it's kind of ugly, but I'm really glad to hear that. Real quick, I have my next thing is my swan song. I'd just like to thank the members of the community for granting me the opportunity to serve on the council for the last 6 years. And I'm extremely appreciative of that opportunity that I've had. And I guess I'd just like to offer a few comments. You know, I would like to say that I think the world of our town staff. They are absolutely exceptional and extremely dedicated, and I can't express enough how really just grateful I am and proud that these are people in our possession and that some other community hasn't stolen them away. We would not function as well as we do without our town clerk, without our town manager, without our great police chief who, you know, is spearheading these great efforts. Our fire chief was chief of the year. These aren't, you know, coincidences. We've taken the time and thoughtful consideration, and we have wonderful people who you can't ever leave. So I do just want to say, again, thank you to town staff. They're fantastic. I've enjoyed working with you, my fellow counselors, past years and present years. And there's been some interesting ones. I've even had some family on the council. That makes it interesting sometimes. And then we did butt heads once or twice. Just saying. I do want to say congratulations to the council-elect. You have Robert Rowan, Chris Chiazzo. Congratulations. Thank you to the folks that did run. And I do just want to say I will miss you, Ed. You're a great quality, that straightforward, straight shooter. And like you said, everyone else just said, is I never had to guess what you were thinking. You always just told it like it was. It was short. It was sweet. It was to the point. You didn't get rambly. You didn't keep going with it. You were there. And that's a great, honesty is a great quality in a person. So it's been a pleasure. Sad to see. Well, no, I'm not sad. I'm going. But no, I'm just teasing. And so my last thing is, and I do just, I do have my own condolence. My last one is for my grandmother, Althea Green, and that was hard. But so I do just want to offer one kind of note about her is that I'd like to really extend not only my special thanks, but the special thanks of my family as well. We were very fortunate to be able to spend our last times with her at the Gosnell House, and they really were phenomenal. And I'd also like to express my special thanks and gratitude to a very special cousin of mine by the name of Cindy Hawks, who spent every day there with us as well. So, with that, my, that's it. So, item number 12 is a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second?